It's a valley of gloom at the moment. Charlton haven't won here yet this season, and results yesterday sent them crashing to the bottom of the Premiership.
If we don't start picking up some home wins soon, then it's going to start getting serious. We play Middlesbrough and we've got to pick a winner.
But Borough are flying. It's almost a record start for them, and they are serious.
We are on target. We're not above target, we're not below. But from now on becomes the true test.
Still one of the great footballing fairy tales, you know, Charlton Athletic back at the Valley, and what a valley it is these days as well. But they have to be careful. It is getting very, very serious for them. This is their worst start in the Premiership. We're at the Valley, live from the Barclaycard Premiership. It's Charlton against Middlesbrough. We're also with Spurs and Bolton today. We've got goal highlights from White Hart Lane during the course of the afternoon. They kick off there at 4 o'clock at Whelan, and we'll be up to date with everything that's happening. Well, on the weekend when Arsenal finally lost, a 16-year-old rewrote the record books and Liverpool went top. Can Charlton win here for the first time this season and haul themselves off the bottom? Gordon McQueen is with us, so too Charlton's injured skipper Graham Stewart, who's probably the best man to answer that question. It's about time you won here, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question about that. We desperately need a win here today. Unfortunately, things haven't gone too well again here at the Valley this season, so we need to right that as quickly as possible.
Why is that?
Well, we didn't end last season very well here at the Valley, and obviously you go into the new season full of optimism and hope, and we went 2-0 up on the first day of the season against Chelsea. Unfortunately, got Paul Konchesky sent off, and we just couldn't hang on in the end, and they got a lucky deflection in the last minute straight into Frank Lampard's path, and all of a sudden we'd lost another game, and everything's gone against us from there, really.
How far can you afford to let it go, Gordon, in this situation before you really start to concern yourselves? Because you'll have been through this with Middlesbrough.
I think there's still plenty of time left in the season to put things right, but it's you don't win your home games. Any club that has a poor record at home, clubs that you'd expect to be mid-table or below, if you don't start picking up points at home, as Alan Kirby says, you end up in serious, serious trouble. And as maybe Graham says, maybe a bit of a hangover from last season, but obviously they've got serious problems at home, not scoring goals, conceding goals. I mean, I watched the game, maybe a little bit unfortunate as well. I watched the Charlton-Manchester United game and they didn't play at all badly. They were 1-0 up at half-time and deservedly so. And then made bad defensive errors in the second half and Manchester United ran out comfortable winners. And the away game at Fulham, by all accounts, played half-decent. But it's a terrible feeling for players when you're turning up for your home games, worrying about them. I mean, it used to be Charlton Athletic, you'd think, when I was at Middlesbrough, you'd think, crikey, down in the Valley, this is a really tough game. Well, Middlesbrough are favourites today, and they'll be fancying getting a win here, and that's not always been the case when you come to play Charlton away.
Of course you've got to win your fair share of home games, but has there not been something of a trend in the Premiership in recent years that those at the bottom end actually tend to do better away from home? And if that is the case, why?
Well, certainly that was the case for us last year. Our record away from home was far better than our record at home. And I think there's a lot of good counter-attacking sides in the Premiership, and that may be a reason why you're seeing the smaller clubs losing at home. Because, you know, you think it being a home game, it's for you to take the initiative and what have you, and you push forward to try and score goals and make things happen, and all of a sudden these good sides take you. And three passes later, they're in your half, and it's a goal. And we see Arsenal, Man United, Liverpool do it week in, week out.
Oh, Gordon said Middlesbrough are favourites. Arsenal were when they went to Goodison yesterday. So you see, favourites can come unstuck, can't they? Top doesn't make very good reading for Charlton right now. They hit rock bottom yesterday. As you can see, they do have a game in hand. If they win it, well, they'll make some considerable progress today. Bolton and Sunderland are in there as well. Bolton, remember, go to Spurs today, and we'll keep an eye on White Hart Lane as well. They kick off at 4 o'clock there. Manchester City are getting themselves into trouble. The Hammers off the bottom this weekend and up into 16th. Then come West Brom and Aston Villa, who play tomorrow night against Southampton on the Monday Night Football, Birmingham and Newcastle. Leeds are down into 10th this weekend. Everton up into 9th on the back of their win. Blackburn going along very nicely now as well. Fulham falling. Spurs play today, as we've said. Chelsea up into 5th at the moment. Middlesbrough still mixing it with the big fellas up there in 4th. Manchester United, Arsenal and Liverpool, just one defeat in 27 now for them, are top of the pile. Coming up on a Super Sunday, we'll hear from Steve McLaren, who's masterminding the resurgence at the Riverside. We'll be going down the river as well. And we'll be taking a look round, well, I suppose you could call it the new valley. OK, let's get the team sorted out. Claire Tomlinson.
Well, Richard, there is some good news for Charlton fans. Long-term casualties Gary Rowett and Scott Parker both return for Charlton as Alan Kirbishley shuffles his pack in an attempt to get off the mark here at the Valley. Any plans Steve McLaren might have had to name an unchanged side for the third consecutive game have been scuppered, though. Alan Botchett has a bruised foot. Gillard Nemeth, fresh from that goal against England, will deputise. Dean Kiely has not kept a clean sheet here at the Valley since January. Rowett, who's missed the last eight with a back injury, comes into a reshaped defence alongside Mark Fish and Richard Rufus. Scott Parker makes his first appearance of the season after an ankle injury. Former Middlesbrough midfielder Robbie Mustoe comes in after passing a late fitness test. And up front, goals have been hard to come by, but Sean Bartlett, he's not scored in his last 17. And Jason Euell, he has just one this season. It's Luke Young who drops down to the bench. Borough, by contrast, can score and keep clean sheets. Mark Schwarzer and his defence have six clean sheets in their 9 league games so far. At the other end, Cameroon international Geremi has 2 goals in the last 2 games. Joseph Job has 2 already. Nemeth has 3. And club record signing Massimo Maccarone has 4. Well, the fans haven't been daunted by the fact that Charlton haven't won a game here at the Valley yet. Middlesbrough returned 2,000 tickets for this fixture. They've all been snapped up by the home fans.
Good, should be quite an atmosphere for all that. Now, he's not prone to sweeping predictions, but when we arrived here today, Andy Gray did say to me, Martin, I'd like you to pursue this, there's no way this will finish goalless. Why not?
Well, the last 3 games between Charlton and Middlesbrough have finished goalless. I think that's right. Andy was referring to. And I'm sure it won't finish goalless. I agree with Mr. Gray.
I don't think so. I mean, I do think that we're about to see a Middlesbrough side playing with more confidence than many Middlesbrough sides over the years. They're happy with the way they're playing. They're comfortable with the system that the coach has got them playing. There are a lot of new players who have settled in really well. And I think they'll go and try and win the game. And I also think Charlton will, having, as we've just heard, had 2,000 tickets sent back, snapped up, will have a full house here. And I think they will obviously go forward and try and win the game. You can never predict goals, Keezy. You know, you keep trying time and time again. There'll be chances in this game. Whether they're taken is another thing.
You just think about they were very level, though, as the 0-0 mm-hmm. showed last season. And yet Middlesbrough have gone upwards and onwards. And Charlton, who haven't had much money to invest, to be fair to Alan Kirbishley, unlike Middlesbrough, they've gone the other way. It's really a big surprise at this stage of the season. There's such a split between the two clubs.
Well, two things, I think. The ability of Middlesbrough to give the coach, Steve McLaren, money to spend, big money,
very
in
big
the summer, to go and strengthen the squad. And I do think Alan's been hindered by the loss of big key players. We've got one sitting in our studio that hasn't kicked a ball and is not likely to, Graham, until the beginning of next year. They lost Gary Rowett. Parker's just coming back. I think they've lost key players at a time when they didn't need to, and it really has cost them. And plus the fact that when you look at the form the strikers are in at the moment, it's not great.
You're getting back to 0-0 again.
No, I'm not. Goals.
It's a great day for playing, Richard. There's a bit of zip around the pitch, a bit of rain in the air, and I'm sure Mr. Gray would love to be out there on the pitch.
Racism and football have been top of the agenda too much these past few weeks. The Kick It Out campaign will be in the spotlight here again today, and Claire Tomlinson reports.
It's National Anti-Racism Week. Clubs up and down the country have their own initiatives, none more so than here at the Valley, where Charlton Athletic are celebrating 10 years of their own campaign, Red, White and Black. They're the only club with full-time staff devoted to the initiative through the Charlton Athletic Race Equality Programme, or CARE. And today, as well as many other awareness initiatives, they are awarding the CARE Awards for the first time. And with me, the recipient of one of those awards, Paul Elliott. Paul, just explain to us, how did the Red, Black and White right campaign get started up?
Well, it started 10 years ago, and I think Charlton Athletic, they identified that there were certain problems, racism in sport, and clearly it was a positive message of intent to try and eradicate it wholly from football, and they've done a wonderful job over the last 10 years, and they've had a tremendous infrastructure and a wonderful model, working with kids at grassroots level right throughout the whole infrastructure, and to the professional players, taking a active part in the community, working hard, you know, to send out positive message of intent to everybody concerned.
It's a time when, of course, the race issue has become front page news again, unfortunately. Do you feel it's more of a problem in Europe, and that really here in England, campaigns such as this one have really done their best to eradicate the problem within our own football grounds?
Firstly, it is a big problem in Europe, and obviously it's far more prevalent in Europe than what it is in this country. But clearly in the UK, we're in a multicultural, multiracial society. The wonderful thing is that there's football legislation, the Football Offences Act of 1991, and that's been adhered to correctly. A lot of the clubs, if not all of the clubs, have made a wonderful input and have been very, very positive. But obviously, as recent events have showed, there cannot be room for any complacency. But certainly in Europe, we need UEFA now to obviously stamp out. We're reliant on the footballing authorities to try and deal with this situation in a very, very positive manner, because it's totally unacceptable in society.
And do you think that really, like, the message is getting through?
I think so, yes. I mean, UEFA came up with a 10-point plan last week, and obviously a lot of clubs have got to adhere to that, particularly those behind the high-end curtain. But I think eventually, I mean, you have to recognise that racism is a bigger problem in society than what it is in football. You've got non-footballing people that use and obviously use football to launch their own recruitment drives. So I think certainly in this country, I speak positively and confidently, but without obviously complacency.
10 years then for Charlton Athletics award system. Here's to another 10 years.
Yeah, very well spoken, Paul Elliott. He's right, isn't he? It is, without being dismissive of the problems, not prevalent to the degree in this country as it is in Europe, and it is a society problem, isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. I don't think there's any doubt about that. I mean, I think it's very, very important to get across the message that we don't seem to have a racism problem in this country. It's come to light more with the clubs going over to Europe, and it seems to be the European sides that have been dishing out the racial abuse. And, you know, as Paul said there's no place for that in football, let alone society.
Another word for racism, ignorance, I think.
Absolutely.
Don't you?
Yeah, for somebody that's not, like myself, it's not the slightest bit racist. It's hard to comprehend the ignorance of people that are. But I think Paul Elliott's right. It's something they've not completely stamped out here, but worked really, really hard on it. The PFA, the FA, players, clubs, and been doing a fantastic job. But it is a major problem in Europe, and it's something that the clubs abroad and people abroad all need to stamp out.
Mm. We're at the Valley this afternoon with Charlton and Middlesbrough. Remember, Spurs and Bolton are playing as well in the capital today, and we'll see goal highlights during the course of the afternoon. They kick off at 4. When we come back, we'll be hearing from Steve McLaren very shortly. We'll be taking a trip down the Thames. And next, we're on a stadium tour of the Valley. If you like your American football tonight at 6, live and interactive, we've a double header. It's the Dolphins against the Buffalo Bills, followed by the Philadelphia Eagles and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Sky Sports Extra from 6 o'clock for that. Right now from the Barclaycard Premiership, it's Charlton and Middlesbrough on a Super Sunday. Also kicking off at 4 o'clock today in the capital, Spurs and Bolton will have goal highlights throughout the afternoon. And tomorrow night, it looks like this. That's Monday Night Football, complete with Fan Zone. Tomorrow, 7 o'clock start, Sky Sports One, the last word in all weekend's football, and live from Villa Park, it's Aston Villa and Gordon Strachan, Southampton. Graham Stewart is with us, Gordon McQueen is with us this afternoon as well. We're at the Valley, and hasn't it changed in these past, 9, 10 years? Can you believe that there was a time when there was no football here? Because Charlton, of course, were playing at Upton Park and Selhurst Park, but they've rebuilt spectacularly. Let's have a closer look round. know I keep banging on about it, but it really is one of the great success stories. As one who sat out Selhurst Park watching Charlton play with, what, 3,500 more, they can pull a few in now that they're back at the Valley, can't they?
They can. We're up to 26,500 people now. And just seeing the clips there, it just makes you realise how far Charlton have come in the last even five years. I mean, the stadium's developed. Some magnificent facilities.
That far end looks really handsome now.
It does. It looks excellent. I mean, we played at the start of last season when that was getting built, and there was a bit of a funny atmosphere, but you know, look at it now, it looks fantastic. And when that's full, and if we can give them something to cheer about, it'll be rocking.
Well, that's the problem right now, isn't it? Charlton sit bottom of the Premiership, and if you look at their form compared to Middlesbrough's, well, that's why Middlesbrough may see it with the big fellas at the top end of the league. That's their form this year in 2002. Charlton have won only 6 of 27. The various facts and figures associated with Charlton, of course, will unfold during the course of the afternoon. Some are shocking, and that's not good form. That's why they're bottom, but there is no panic yet.
You can have every excuse in the world, but you haven't won enough games, and we're bottom of the league, and it's not a nice feeling, but it's not fatal. If it was 5 or 6 games left, I'll be really concerned. Not to say I'm not concerned anyway, but you know, a win today can lift us 4 or 5 places, and we know that the Premiership is so tight at the moment.
What's your biggest concern, the goals you're conceding or the goals you're not scoring?
I think that we haven't got going yet. That's my biggest concern. I think in the 9 games we've probably played quite well in 3 of them and got something from them. Played as well as the opposition in the other 3 but got nothing, and then played poorly and got beat. And I don't think our season has really got going. I'm looking for today, changing it around a little bit, but I'm looking obviously today to get a result and perhaps kick-start our season.
What are the changes you're going to make and what are the reasons behind it?
Well, I've been waiting 8 weeks for Scott Parker and Gary Rowett, and they're going to come back into it. And I've just gone, I think, for a little bit more experience in the side today. Young Paul Konchesky's come out, Luke Young's come out, and I'm just looking for the people, the experienced players, to get hold of the ball and pass it around and do what they can do. You know, I think we've not put them under any pressure. I don't even think the Valley crowd has put them under any pressure. But obviously, you know, they read the papers, they know the situation, and I'm trying to get a performance out of them. So there'll be no pressure put on anybody from us, but I've gone for experience, really.
What's more of a concern to you, Graham, the fact that you're not scoring goals or that you're conceding?
I think it's both, to be honest with Richard. The games we have scored goals, we've made glaring mistakes as well, and we've ended up losing those games. And it's a concern, you know, obviously, if you're losing goals week in, week out, because, you know, a couple of years ago we were nicking games 1-0 and we're looking very, very, you know, defensively solid. But that's not been the case this year. And you put that with the fact that we're struggling to score goals as well. And
Well, struggling doesn't actually do it justice, does it? One of those shocking stats I was talking about is that there's 5 strikers here, Gordon. 69 games they've played collectively between them, and they haven't hit the net. Now that's frightening, isn't it?
Well, that's an incredible statistic. It sounds as if there may be a bit of luck needing done in the training ground, finishing practice. But you need somebody on your side that's going to pop you in a few goals. I mean, you look how Middlesbrough, for example, have improved. They were very solid last year, but they never had a lot of attacking flair going forward. This year they've added to that with Maccarone coming into the side, scoring a few goals for them, and it showed in the position that they're in the league just now. And that's got to start happening for Charlton. Get goals. And as Graham said, I mean, I watched the Charlton-Manchester United game, played well for 45 minutes, but on the defensive side in the second half as well, they let themselves down. But obviously goals are a major, major problem. But they've got people at Euell that will get goals. I mean, obviously Johansson, that's on the bench, scored a few goals a season or so ago, and he's firing blanks just now. But Jason Euell's more than capable of getting Charlton goals.
Top scorer, in fact, is the fella in the middle there. Klaus Jensen with 2. Well, plainly the problem is very evident, Graham, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. With Klaus, you know, scoring 2 goals, but he'll be happy, Klaus, 2 goals in 9 appearances.
Oh, by no way.
No, not at all. I know, exactly. I mean, he'll be delighted with that, but obviously, if your midfield player's the top scorer on your side, that's the problem I'm sure you're on about. And, you know, we need to address that quickly because, as Kerb's pointed out there, I mean, there's no great panic yet. But if it continues to go down the road and you're not picking up points, then every game's become more and more pressurised.
Does he still talk about that one?
No, he's too humble to talk about things like that, Klaus. But everybody knows what a talent he is, and you know, it's a day for big players, and Klaus is a big player, and we need him to give us a good performance.
The bigger the game, does he enjoy it more?
I believe so. I think any top player, the bigger the game, the better they want to perform, and you know, invariably the top players come out, you know, in the top of their game.
He's a classy player, Graham, isn't he? I mean, that's a great goal.
Absolutely.
Against Manchester United. They're picking it up like that and bending it around.
Absolutely. I mean, if games are tight as well, he's the sort of player who can produce something like he did against Manchester United and get you 3 points, and we'd give anything for him to do it today.
Well, Mark Fish there is very much aware that it's not just up front where there's trouble. Charlton have been leaking goals as well. Here's Jeff Shreves.
So, Mark, things not really going quite as they should here at the Valley, are they?
No, not certainly not. We're letting in a few goals at the moment, but let's hope things can sort out themselves for Sunday.
Now, in terms of leaks, I think I know a man, and he's a Charlton man, who might be able to help you stem the tide.
Well, we need all the help we can get, so I'll go with you.
Let's go. Mark, this is Martin Earlham, a man with a very impressive title. He might be able to help you.
Okay, I'm the fence improvements engineer here at the Thames Barrier, and this is the eighth wonder of the world, and it provides the most critical flood defence in the country, and that's protecting the capital city of London. If you put your hats on, I'll come and take you, show you around. It was finished in 1983 when the Queen came down to kind of close it for the first time and press the button and cut the ribbon to say it's now open and functioning. And it cost then £550 million.
Do you use it often at all? Or?
Well, we have to test it once a month to show the barrier can be closed, to demonstrate to the Londoners who were protected by it that it will work. And it's closed 67 times to protect London from flooding in the 20 years since it was finished.
This tunnel is about 400 metres long. The barrier is 520 metres across, but this goes from Pier 9 to Pier 3 on the inside.
That's the area which is protected by both the Thames Barrier and the walls and embankments either side of the Thames.
Is the valley safe at all, or...?
Yeah, the valley's within the flood risk area, but it's protected by the Thames Barrier itself, which would be closed to protect it from tidal flooding.
Mark, would you say that the Thames Barrier is slightly more impressive than Charlton's defence?
Certainly is at this particular moment, but I'd like to think that things can only get better, and hopefully Sunday's a stepping stone for us.
What's been going wrong, do you think?
Well, I just think that once one game goes away and you end up playing very well but you don't get any points from it, it becomes a confidence thing.
Is that compounded at home? Because it's really not happening for Charlton at the Valley this season, not even a single point, and the crowd are starting to get edgy.
No, definitely. It makes it a lot harder once you don't... If you can't get a single point, you haven't had a single point at home yet this season, and everyone knows that you need to win games at home to stay in the Premiership, so it becomes harder and harder. And, you know, obviously the crowd get restless, and it makes it more difficult to be able to play your type of football that you want to play on the day as well. So it does get harder and harder, and, you know, like I keep on saying, hopefully, you know, things will change.
You've had a nightmare time with injury. How frustrating has that been for you?
It's been very frustrating for me, but I'm just one of those people that I look forward to the future now, and you know, the past is the past. I was very disappointed. I have been frustrated, but got to look ahead now, and hopefully, like I said, hopefully things will change for not only myself, but for Charlton, for my teammates and for the supporters on Sunday.
Was it a massive surprise to you how long you were out for what seemed a fairly simple operation?
No, certainly. It was a disaster, to be honest. I only expected to be out for 4 weeks and ended up being out for 8 months, so it was a disaster. It was... The most difficult time of my life, or my career, and just I've got to look forward now, and hopefully there's light at the end of the tunnel.
The gates of the Thames Barrier are actually made from Teesside steel, and they're made up in Middlesbrough, and we've got to hope that the Middlesbrough defence on Sunday isn't as strong as the Thames Barrier gates.
Well, we certainly do hope so.
Yep.
Now, I know he's been keeping a low profile this week, but I'm the only one to have spotted David Seaman in that report. It was him, wasn't it?
Could have been.
It's a ringer. You never know. It was the engineer at the Thames
Barrier. Very good lookalike.
Which is made of Middlesbrough steel, it would appear, and of course the Borough are here today. And what's been happening up there, Gordon?
Quite a lot, in actual fact. I mean, there's an awful lot of optimism about Middlesbrough just now because the team are playing very, very well. I've watched them quite a lot this year. I think last year that they were grinding out results with clean sheets. You know, they're very strong at the back. When you look at Mark Schwarzer, Ehiogu, Southgate, it really is a terrific. They've got a terrific goalkeeper and a terrific central defensive partnership, as good as anything in the league. Maybe Hippier or Henshaw get the nod, but I mean, Southgate and Ehiogu are up there. But this year, he's added to that. I think Steve McLaren realised last year that their attacking options weren't great, and obviously Nemeth come in, Joseph Jobs come back in an attacking midfield role after being in France on loan for a year, and Maccarone's come in and scoring goals. And they were a little bit dull to watch last year, but that's far from the case this year. I think they've been really entertaining and good to watch, still very, very solid defensively and good going forward. And the system Steve McLaren's playing just now certainly suits the players. You know, with Boateng in front of the back two, Joseph Job in the attacking midfield role, and Greening, who's playing really well this year, and Geremi, who's been a real find this year, and things are looking really, really good. I honestly think I felt at the start of the year they could improve in last season's position in the league, but I firmly believe now that they could finish in the top six. I mean, the people that are up against are Leeds, Newcastle, and you know, having watched them, and you know, I think Middlesbrough are every bit as good as Leeds United, every bit as good as Newcastle, maybe Chelsea, another one that you'd think they'd be competing against in the top six. I've got a little bit more quality than Middlesbrough and maybe a bigger squad, but if they get any kind of good fortune with injury suspensions, the rubber of the green, I think they'll be right up there this season.
We'll hear what Steve McLaren's got to say about all that very shortly, but before we do, there's a big reunion going on here at the Valley today. Jeff Shreves has the details.
Richard, with the problems that Charlton are currently experiencing, how Alan Kirbishley would love to call on some of the quality available in this room today. There's over 50 ex-players here today for a reunion, and they look like they're enjoying themselves, so let's see who we can find. I think I've just spotted Theo Foley, former Arsenal assistant manager. Theo, what does it mean to you today, getting together with some old pals?
Well, it's lovely coming back here for me, because a lot of them are not so old, but they look a lot younger than me, because I'm old. But it's terrific. It's a great place to come back to. Smashing club, and always will be.
How much has the Valley changed?
Oh, dramatically. I mean, when I first come, it had that massive steps on the far side. You could see all over Woolwich. Now it's changed. It's compact. It's become a real football ground, and I hope that it will remain so.
Good to see you, Theo. I think over your shoulder I've just spotted 70s goal-scoring legend, for many people the real face of Charlton, and they could certainly do with a few of his goals today, and that is Derek Hales. Excuse me, Derek.
Yes.
I can't just interrupt you. Afternoon, Derek.
Hello.
Good to see you. How much do you enjoy coming back to the Valley?
Well, I don't come back very often, but today's nice. Nice to see the old players.
They're struggling for goals at the moment. Do you wish you could get the old boots on and get out there?
I've got my boots with me. If there ain't any offsides, we'll get a game. Yeah.
How much affection do you have for this club?
Oh, lovely club. I mean, where they went to and where they've come back to is lovely. Unfortunately, they're bottom at the moment, but today go up.
Well, let's hope so. Good to see you, Derek. Now, just now, I thought I saw Gary Nelson of the PFA and former award-winning journalist. Yes, unusually for Gary, he's made a blindside run. If I can just... Excuse me, chaps. Gary Nelson, good to see you. How much are you enjoying today?
Very nice to see a few old faces, and they are getting old.
Is this very much a family club, Charlton, Gary?
This is part and parcel of what Charlton have always been about. I thought that when we played here, when I joined in 91, that the first thing that you felt was a bonding, not only with the players, but with the fans, because of the dire straits that they were in at the time. And I'm happy to see that spirit seems to have been retained whilst they've gone back up into the Premiership. It's not distanced itself from the people that made it all happen, and that includes, as I'm sure Alan Kirbishley would agree, quite a few players that he bought in at the time, because they had no money. That's why he bought me.
Charlton's in your heart. How much do you think they can turn it around starting today?
Well, I have seen them once this season, playing against Spurs, who on the night were the better side. But the thing that you know with Charlton is they'll always give 100%. And they can be a very difficult team to play against. And I think they've got enough quality in the side to... Yeah, it's a false position, to my mind. Played very well against Man United recently. And I'm sure Alan, with his ability and with the squad that he's got, can turn it around.
Thanks, Gary. Wise words from a top-selling author. Let's find out if Gary's right.
Derek Hales, eh? God, he could score goals, that boy. And Jeff's in the company of another 59 Charlton legends. We'll leave him to his own devices. We're at the Valley this afternoon. It's Charlton and Middlesbrough. When we come back, we'll be hearing from Middlesbrough's main man, Steve McLaren. It's a Super Sunday this afternoon from the Valley. It's Charlton, who haven't won here yet this season, and Middlesbrough. Also playing this afternoon in the capital, Spurs and Bolton. That kicks off at 4 o'clock. We'll have goal highlights during the course of the afternoon. Next Sunday, the pay-per-view offering looks like this. Next Sunday's Barclaycard Premiership pay-per-view offering, 08705 160 160 for more information on how to order that match. It starts Sunday at 1:30 and it comes from St Mary's at Southampton against Fulham. Well, now a word from the man masterminding Middlesbrough's resurgence this season, Steve McLaren with Claire Tomlinson.
It was with Jim Smith at Derby that Steve McLaren first began to make his mark as a coach. And a productive period at Pride Park paved the way for a move to Manchester United as assistant to Sir Alex Ferguson.
I remember the first game he invited me. I spoke on the Friday. He says, come and join us in the hotel. Come and to the game against Forest on the Saturday and just join in. And that was it. I thought, my God, I'm thrown into the lion's den here. And the team won 8-1. And I thought, my God, what do I do on Monday morning? What do I do now? How do you better this? So it was daunting, but I just wanted to be the best at what I could do. And I developed on, and gradually I got higher and higher, and working for Manchester United and looking at the next challenge, the next step, and thinking eventually I would like to, you know, a club of my own and to try and build something the way that Jim had done it at Derby and Sir Alex had done at Manchester.
He played a key coaching role in United's treble-winning season before the lure to go it alone became too strong. Middlesbrough offered him the opportunity to be a manager, but his fledgling career was almost over before it had begun, as his new team lost their first four games. It was a lesson well learned.
I remember chatting with Sir Alex and just talking about being number one, and, you know, before I took the job, just in general, as you do. And he seemed to think at the time that he said I'd have no problems. And because management and being number one is all about making decisions. As a number two, you can give advice and you can make recommendations, but sat in that chair and saying that's what we're going to do is the most difficult thing. And it's something which I found quite easy. I wouldn't say easy, some of the decisions have been difficult, but I can sleep at night and I can look at the results and say it's down to me, it's my fault if we fail, it's mine if we succeed. I've made that decision, and that's, I think, the difference between being number one, being number two. We consolidated last year and brought the wage bill down, brought the playing staff down, brought the age of the squad down. And we had a bit of success, an FA Cup semi-final, comfortable finish. And then the chairman in the summer, I think, you know, said, right, let's go for it a bit. And he's been absolutely fantastic, providing me with the resources to go out and spend some money and to improve the squad. And I believe we've done that. I like what I see in their eyes. I like the way they train. I like the culture that they've got, the work ethic that they've got. They want to stay out and practice, they want to improve. And as long as they've got that, and like I say to them, get up in the morning, look forward to coming to work and enjoying that. And if we can get results along the way, then great.
He's added England to his coaching CV and is widely tipped to be Sven's successor. But that's very much in the future for the Borough boss.
I came into the England scene helping them out I'm still there helping them out. It's a very easy relationship that we've got. It's one of them in which, you know, it's game by game and can be ended any time and can go on, but I keep going on. But ultimately, Middlesbrough is where I'm judged. It's where, if I'm going to be successful and going to move on and into higher things, I have to be a success at Middlesbrough Football Club. So ultimately, the test is here.
What's the difference, Gordon, between being coach and manager?
Well, I think everybody knew about Steve McLaren's coaching abilities before he came. But I think it's his management that's impressed people. Obviously, it's completely different from being a number two, being a manager. Obviously, still does his coaching on the training ground. But I think you've got to be impressed by what he's achieved in the last 18 months or so. Last year, he built, consolidated, and a really solid defence. He knew that the problems going forward. He was patient in the transfer market, which is a strength of any manager. And then I think one of the most important things in management is buying well. And I think when he got the backing of the chairman, Steve Gibson, at the summer, he went out and he bought well. And I think that's crucial in the success of any manager. And that's something he's done really, really well at. I mean, all his signings, I mean, we're looking at one here, Maccarone, that they've all been successful. I mean, it was a surprise to a lot of people when they paid the $8.5 million for him in Police Serie B, particularly when none of the big Italian clubs had went in for him. Everybody was wondering why. Well, whether it was Italian clubs just never had the money or not, I'm not quite sure. But certainly Middlesbrough backed their judgment, and his judgment's been spot on because he looks a player that's...
He was actually honest enough to admit that he would never have thought about Maccarone had Steve Bruce and Birmingham not moved.
Well,
it didn't quite work out for Steve, did it? But they made it work.
These things happen in the transfer world, but he's a player that's swift. I mean, you watch the likes of this here. Left foot, he'll score them with his right foot. He's very, very positive when he gets anywhere near the penalty box whatsoever. Rings at defenders. 30 yards from goal when he's got the ball, he's thinking goal all the time. Good head of the ball as well, although it helps when you've got somebody like Queudrue taking the set pieces, which is one of Middlesbrough's assets as well. This is Jonathan Greenan, who I think's had a really good season for Middlesbrough. Maybe a bit fortunate here. This is the last time they played in London and hammered Spurs 3-0 today. That's why I think Middlesbrough scored goals at the Valley here today. And it really has been, well, you've got to say, an inspired signing. I know it's early days yet and there's a long way to go, but the signs are terrific. And I think he's formed a really good partnership with Alan Boxic. I know Boxic isn't playing today, and Nemeth's coming in, who obviously English fans know a bit more about now after the game in Slovakia last week. But it's a good partnership, whatever way you look at Maccarone, Nemeth, Maccarone, Boxic, and he really has been a terrific signing.
And speaking of money, they've spent as much in 2 years as Alan Kirbishley has in eight here at the Valley. That's one of the beauties.
Yeah, that is. I mean, to
Geremi, incidentally, he's on loan. He's not cost money yet.
Graham will tell you, when he spent it well, Alan Kirbishley. Jason, you'll close Jensen, that we've talked about already in this programme. And it must be a little bit frustrating for him when he sees the likes of Steve Gibson coming up with £20 million or whatever in the summer. Although that 20 million still got to be spent well, and obviously this guy coming in as well, Geremi. They've actually got a midfield that's full of running in Middlesbrough, with Geremi, Greening, Joseph Job, all run for fun, box to box all day long, and Boateng that sits just in front of the back four. But it's certainly an energetic midfield, and he's been another one that's been a terrific loan signing.
Without being unkind to George Butty, when we read in the summer that he wanted out from Aston Villa and was heading to Middlesbrough, were you a little bit surprised by that?
Perhaps a little bit, yes, but I don't think there's any doubt that every team needs a George Boateng in it, and he does the simple things very, very well. He breaks things up, and when you've got now the attacking flair that Middlesbrough have got in Maccarone, Job, Geremi, what have you, you need somebody to just sit in the middle of the park there and break things up if sides break out quickly. And I think he's been an inspired signing for them. Maccarone may get the headlines, but he's been an excellent signing for them.
Well, no doubt in his mind that he's made the right decision. No regrets at all from Boateng.
For me, it's not about getting right, whether I made the right decision or not. I am happy, and that's very important for me. My family as well. But it's good that we're winning. and it's early. We've played only 9 games. I've been on top with Villa in December and still crumbled down the rest of the season. So I'll be happy when December comes and we're still somewhere in the top 8. But, money can buy players, but not a team. At this moment, we've got a team more than just individual good players. Any team likes to play a team that plays football more than fighting. It's for us somehow strange, but it's nicer to play Man United than playing Charlton, because you know Charlton are going to work extremely hard. You know, you have to sort of pass each player twice before you get through. So it makes it harder for us.
And what's your role in the team? What's your job?
Well, it will be similar as Aston Villa. But I feel I have more room, more space, in terms of if there is a gap for me to go forward, I should not be afraid. You know, I can go knowing that there will be always somebody taking my place. While I was at Villa, it has never been like that. I was always scared more or less going forward because I knew most of the time there was no one, you know, taking my place. And it gives you also a confident feeling of playing. So sometimes if there is a gap, so far I haven't scored yet. I'm still waiting for my first goal. I hoped when we played Bolton, I was hoping Geremi would square the ball, and then he did it himself. So I said, lucky, but if you would have missed, I would have killed you. but that's good. I'll get a goal.
Just one thing he said there about the team ethic. So important if you're going to have any kind of success. Is that missing here? Because that's something that Charlton also have prided themselves on down the years, isn't it?
No, I don't think it's missing. It's not quite working at the moment. That's the problem. As you quite rightly say, we prided ourselves on a team ethic over the years, and that's what's brought us our success so far. And whilst individuals will win you the odd game, the team and the squad that we've got here and Kerbs has assembled, that's the reason why we're playing Premiership football. And that'll be the squad will be the thing that gets us out of it as well.
And how difficult is it in your position when you're not playing but you have a responsibility about the club? Do you feel like you can stick your head in the dressing room, or do you feel like an imposter if you're not playing?
No, I try to stick my head in the dressing room. It probably sick to death for me, to be honest with you. But Kerbs was good enough to give me the captaincy, and I feel a certain responsibility, although I can't get out on the pitch, to chat to the lads and G them up as best I possibly can. And you know, if one or two's heads go down, then it's perhaps my responsibility to have a chat with them and make sure they're, you know, looking at things in a different light and looking at things positively, because we have to be upbeat about things, otherwise we get dragged down into it.
Having not won here all season long, this is a massive day out for Charlton, isn't it?
Yeah, well, as we mentioned earlier, they've got to start winning games. You've got to pick up points at home. Oh, that's a recipe for disaster. And as Alan Kirbishley said earlier on in the programme, I mean, I'll start getting serious if this run continues. You know, too right it will. And I think it's important that you're just talking about team ethics there and team spirit. That stays at a high level. If you lose that, you've had it. I'm sure they won't. I think it's something that Middlesbrough have got in abundance just now. But it also helps when you're winning games. When you're not winning games, confidence drains. Team spirit isn't as good. When you are winning games, it can make a good team into a very good team.
What's the key to them undoing Middlesbrough today?
They've got to start scoring goals. I mean, it's as simple as that. Their goal scoring record's worse than poor, and they're up against the meanest defence in the Premier League, one of the best goalkeepers in the Premier League, one of the best central defensive partnerships in the Premier League. So they're up against it before they start, but they've got to start knocking in goals.
So anything off your backside, your
a rub of the green, a little bit of luck that gets them the victory that they desperately need. I don't think they'll get it as it happens, but get them the victory they desperately need, and then they may be going a little bit of
will Middlesbrough get it then, just to complete
I think
that?
It'll be very, very tight. I don't think it's easy coming to Charlton at any time. I don't care whether they're bottom in the league or not. I think it's a difficult place to win, and I think it'll be a really tight game, but Middlesbrough are favourites today, and I think rightly so, and I think they'll just edge it.
They have lost, Borough, only 2 of the last 15 and won 8 against Charlton, who are unbeaten in 4 here. They've won 2 of those. November 94, Borough's last win. Hendry and Pollock, the scorers, in a 2-0. The last 3 have finished goalless. But that won't happen today. Join our match commentators Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
Richard, Middlesbrough have never won here in the Premiership. But I must say, Andy, I'm looking forward to having seen some very exciting clips of their football this season, to seeing Middlesbrough, the new Middlesbrough, play.
My first look at them live as well, Martin. I'm really looking forward to seeing a couple of the players, particularly Massimo Maccarone, obviously, as an ex-striker myself. I'm really looking forward to seeing how he copes today. It'll be a little bit different for him today, because Alan Kirbishley has shifted it around a little bit, changed one or two little things, and it'll be interesting to see how he copes today. But he's one I'm really looking forward to seeing, and Geremi's another who's come in this season, and it really has. Both of them have taken the Premiership a little bit by storm.
They've made it Middlesbrough Athletic, strangely at the home of Charlton Athletic, but they are a very athletic side, Middlesbrough. Let's look at the Charlton lineup first. And Robbie Mustoe plays against the club he served splendidly for 12 years. His fitness after a groin problem only confirmed today, but he's in. Alongside him, Scott Parker finally gets his first game of the season. That's good news for Charlton. They badly missed his marauding midfield play. Also back after missing the last seven Premiership games, Gary Rowett, Alan Kirbishley's one major summer signing. Luke Young and Paul Konchesky miss out, and Konchesky not in fact involved at all. Middlesbrough have had players spread far and wide over the past 10 days, as well as the manager's time with England. Just the one casualty, Alan Boksic, came back from playing for Croatia with a bruised foot. But Zilard Nemeth, fresh from his goal against England 8 days ago, delighted to get the chance to reclaim his Middlesbrough place. Middlesbrough have certainly speculated to accumulate, and the three newcomers, Boateng, Geremi and Maccarone, have all fitted in, as Andy was saying, extremely quickly.
Well, it's 4-3 for Charlton today. It really is a change that I think he felt he had to make, with Rufus, Rowett and Fish in tandem at the back, and Scott Parker back for his first game in the centre of that midfield this season. But it's a very fluid system, Martin. I think these three, I'll try and keep it nice and tight. If they're going to give space away, it will be down the sides, I think. Let them get it down the sides, but don't let anything come through the middle. That'll be the key today, and they can change it. I think if it's not going well with Alan Kirbishley, and he always likes to match it up, and what you might find is that Rowett, for instance, might find himself at right back. He could go in with the two centre backs. Chris Powell back to his normal position. Scott Parker might just drop back in there. Jensen would definitely come up here. You know, it sounds a lot and it looks complicated, but don't be surprised if it ain't going well for Charlton if this isn't plan B and they can adapt to that. That's something to look for if it ain't going well for the home side. Middlesbrough, well, it's basically as you were, Mark. It's a back four, it's a solid back four. Gordon McQueen's already told what he thinks of it. I do think Ehiogu and Southgate are as good as any pairing in the country. And that quartet of midfield players that they've got in there in that diamond shape seem to be getting better and better. Disappointing that Boksic isn't playing, because I'd like to have seen that. But this position here, Georges Boateng, now that's becoming a hugely important position now in football. You think of Liverpool with the players, Dietmar Hamann that does that, Vieira does it great, Keane does it great. There are big teams now put such a big emphasis on that position. It was interesting to hear George talk that if he gets forward and he's being allowed to, with the other two, I don't think Job's going to drop back. I don't think Greening's the one to drop back. I think Jeremy's the most defensive-minded of the others. I think he would be the one to fill in there. But I think he likes it that way, the coach. And I don't think Steve McLaren would want George Boateng going too much forward. And as I say, really looking forward to seeing Maccarone play today.
A sharp contrast in the early season form of two clubs that finished last season just a point apart and have finished level against each other in their last three meetings. Charlton consigned after yesterday's games to the bottom of the Premiership, and a look at that league table should add extra incentive to their efforts over the next couple of hours. As for Middlesbrough, well, they've not quite had the exacting fixture list of Charlton, but they have reached the upper echelons with the sort of polished performances that suggest they may just be able to stay up there. Only October, but it is a vital afternoon at the Valley. Charlton very much in need of their first home points of the season. In their way, in for Middlesbrough. It's live right after the break.
Charlton Middlesbrough for us live on a Super Sunday. Remember, Spurs and Bolton are about to kick off at White Hart Lane, and we'll have goal highlights from there as well. It's part of our interactive service this afternoon. You can pick up Fan Zone push the red button on your remote control and follow the instructions. First up, as a feature of player cam, Massimo Maccarone. That's for Sky Digital viewers. Match commentators, Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
Thanks, Richard. Quite a day for Robbie Mustoe after all those years of service for Middlesbrough. He plays against them. He still lives on Teesside. And his son, Elliot, who is down for half-term, is a very big Middlesbrough fan. His dad might just spoil his day today. In the era of significant outside influence at the top level of football in this country, this is a contest between two of the brightest young English managers. No disguising, though, a sticky spell for Alan Kirbish's team, particularly here at the Valley. Steve McLaren knows all about those difficulties. A year ago, he was really struggling, but now he's steering Middlesbrough onwards and upwards. Neale Barry is the referee. A little bit of rain around in South London today. Contrast to yesterday when it was a frosty morning in the southeast. A bit of a frosty time for Charlton Athletic. Charlton to kick off with just 1 point from their last five games. Just one goal in those five matches, and they're against today the meanest defence in the country. Mark Fish, only recently fit again, looking for his fellow South African Sean Bartlett. Parker. It was Bartlett on Boateng. And Neale Barry has called the Charlton striker across. Chris Powell having his say. Andy Gray, have your say.
Well, that's one of those we talk about time and time again. Ain't the first time this season you and I have debated that. And it's again a striker coming across. He wants to follow through. He kicks the bottom of Bartlett's foot. It's a really hard one, Martin, if you get it to block the ball. It happens time and time again. And I think too many referees are too quick to bring a card out. So there's no doubt about that.
And quick, no doubt about that. I don't think it's quite in the Vinnie Jones category.
No, not quite.
Straight from the kickoff.
But it can be a nasty one. It's that kind of area with a lot of bones in the top of the foot. When you kick the bottom of someone's boot like that, it really can cause some damage. I hope that's not the case.
Bob Ward is the Middlesbrough physio. Ehiogu. Sure, he's aiming for Queudrue. Involved him, he couldn't control it. Here's Jason Euell. Chance in this system for Powell to push forward down the left-hand side. Robinson doing the equivalent job on the right for Charlton. Parker and Jensen and Mustoe, central midfield trio.
Yeah, Musto's just a holding player. You see him there just picking it up. He's the one who's going to play in front of the three centre-backs, Martin. I think it's going to be up to Parker and Jensen, the central area, to be the two midfield players that go forward and try and influence the play.
Klaus Jensen is the only Charlton player who scored, if you count the Worthington Cup game here, and that was a pretty ignominious one. They went out penalties after a goalless draw with Oxford United in the third division. Klaus Jensen, the only player to score in the last six games for Charlton. It's a wonderful goal, mind you, against Manchester United.
You know, much has been made of their home format, but it hasn't been an easy start. Three London derbies, Chelsea, Arsenal, Spurs, are not easy games, and then you chuck in Manchester United alongside that. It's a tough start they have at home.
And of course they were so close to starting with a win against Chelsea. They were going well. They lost Paul Konchesky, a contentious red card, and then on a very hot day just ran out of steam. The opening day of the season always difficult at the best of times, and
Chelsea scored twice late on to win 3-2. Could easily have been 3 points for Charlton that day. On such things, maybe the die can be cast. Now they've got to break down Gareth Southgate. Southgate and Ehiogu, of course, were in the England squad for the two European qualifiers. Southgate played in Slovakia against Nemeth, his clubmate, who scored. But Ehiogu didn't get on the pitch and wasn't even on the bench for the match against Macedonia. Queudrue. A swing and nearly a miss by Boateng, then a slice by his left foot. Fish. Queudrue all over Robinson, right in front of the referee.
Tried to get in front and nick it. I think he caught the left arm as much as anything, the ball. It was a good chance early in the game. Fair distance out. I always think conditions like this, Mark, when it is wet, is skippy, off the grass surface, I think what the goalkeeper now tests his handling early on.
Mark and follow it in. Here's the goalkeeper. Klaus Jensen is eyeing up the possibilities. Doesn't go the direct route. But it's in, and Euell has given Charlton the lead inside 5 minutes.
What a start, and a lovely, lovely goal. Super delicate free kick, and a fantastic header from Jason Euell. And it's just about muscling them out. They're marked really, really tightly. Nothing wrong with the marking at all. You can't get any tighter than this. Is that Hugo Ehiogu?
Well, I just wonder whether Euell did get the... Yeah, he did. Yeah. It might have been another touch off Ehiogu as well, but it's Jason Ewell's goal.
It's lovely free kick. I mean, he fed it in beautifully. Obviously felt he was a little too far out, Klaus Jensen. A lot would have been tempted, as I was saying. He worked the goalkeeper, tested his handling. Fed a lovely ball in. And to be fair to Charlton, he didn't half attack it well.
As you said earlier in the day, this would not be a 0-0 draw.
There you go.
We made that point because something we weren't going to dwell upon for you, the last three meetings between Charlton and Middlesbrough all ended goalless draws. Middlesbrough have more firepower these days. Now they've got to show it. Their mean defence has been breached very early on.
It's good high tempo from Charlton. I'm not surprised. I think when you're on the kind of form and run that Charlton are in, you send your team out, particularly at home, Martin, to be high tempo, on the front foot. They've certainly started like that in the opening 6 minutes, and I don't think it's any coincidence. I think Alan would have asked for that. He would have demanded it. A quick start, but he couldn't have dreamt the goal would come as early.
Spent Friday morning, the coaching staff working on Charlton in the attacking third of the pitch. Jason Euell have gone 8 games without a goal, only 2 in his previous 19 matches. Don't really want to embarrass the Charlton strikers by going through those statistics, but a pretty sorry tale of lack of goal getting. For Jason Euell, it's changed already. Greening. Maybe Mustoe going with him and fouling him. Mustoe was offered a contract by Middlesbrough for this season. He played in virtually every game for them last season. He chose to explore free agency, as they might say in the United States. He's got a 3-month deal here with Charlton Athletic.
Bit rash, the challenge. Jonathan Greening wasn't going anywhere, Mark. But that's the nature of the way they started Charlton. They're rattling into everybody. Quite prepared to put in a few tackles early in the match. But it gives Middlesbrough a chance to put pressure in with a good ball in.
It's Mustoe who got to it. And Rufus, Middlesbrough's throw. More needed in the middle, maybe. Geremi. Stockdale's cross. Comes out to Boateng. touch down by Mustoe.
Good hit, good block.
That's George Boateng again. Geremi taking over from him. Rufus got in between Job and Maccarone. It's Macaroni's ball. It was a thoughtful one into the run of Frank Queudrue.
It's Mustoe's job. Great bit of covering. He spotted the danger. He saw Queudrue advancing into the ball and very quickly got over there and made a great tackle. It was a good spell this from Middlesbrough. It's been a really good response to going behind.
Charlton at the moment, having scored, can't get out of their own half.
Oh, that'll help.
Jensen. Geremi on a season-long loan from Real Madrid. Parker. Oh, Charlton are pleased to have him back in harness, looking for Jason Euell. Scott Parker damaged an ankle in a pre-season game. They thought he'd be out for a couple of weeks, but it's turned out to be a lot longer than that.
Yeah, I think they've missed him. Missed his energy, his quality.
Fish, one of the back three across to take the throw, and another of the back three, Richard Rufus, trying to be on the receiving end of it. Goes over Rufus, who's certainly made a nuisance of himself. The shot from Mustoe.
Deflection.
Corner.
Reflection. Lovely strike. Not his strongest side, but just watch the way he does it, thrash at it. A lot of people do that when it's on your weaker side. He just controls it. Lovely. Very big flick off Gareth Southgate, I think. It certainly would have worked a goalkeeper.
Jensen with the corner this time. Headed by Rowett. Middlesbrough struggling to curb with the Charlton restarts.
They've got good height, Charlton. And they've got four players who come in, all going in a bunch, attacking the ball. They don't get close enough to Rowett, Martin.
Quate. Goes down by Parker. Jensen, swept forward by Mustoe. Southgate is getting across ahead of Jason Euell.
Oh, a bit of news that might cheer Charlton fans up. An interesting stats, Martin. The fact that any time Middlesbrough have won a game this season, they haven't conceded. Any time they've conceded, they haven't won the football match.
Yes, this is only the fourth match that they've conceded in. It's their tenth in the Premiership. McLaren's side lost at Everton, lost at Manchester United, and then were 2-0 up against the Fulham into the closing moments of the game, and that extraordinarily finished 2-2 at the Riverside. Well, this ball has been given away down in front of us by Middlesbrough on a far too regular occurrence for Steve McLaren's liking.
Well, the five for Charlton are doing a pretty good job earlier on there. The majority stopped the flow of ball to the front two, Martin. You know, Nemeth and Maccarone really have had nothing to work on at all.
That's was an ambitious ball back towards Robinson. Parker's in there. Sent tumbling by Job.
Clumsy, no more than that.
A little further back for Jensen, in fact it's too far back for him to want to be involved in the taking of it compared to the one that led to Euell's opening goal. Well, it tries to oblige, Euell's in there again.
Well, it's George Boateng who's marking him, Martin, and didn't do a very good job of it there. He tried to step out initially and play offside and almost got caught. A little bit more on the header and it might have been the same result.
Bartlett, who was a singled out for a special mention by Sir Alex Ferguson when Manchester United played here and won, even the manager thought, fortunately, from Charlton's previous home game. Greening. Mustoe defending well again.
It is such an important area of the pitch, that, isn't it, when you're defending, Mark? If you can get someone to sweep in front of your back two or your back three, as it is for Charlton today.
It's a great help for Robbie Mustoe that he probably knows more about the opposition than he does about his own team.
That's another silly free kick, Richard Rufus. Sometimes you can't get the ball. Sometimes you have to just let people get it and deal with it then.
Queudrue. It's a good take by Job.
Star
is back in the ascendancy again at Middlesbrough. He was surplus to requirements last season. He was sent out on loan to Metz in France. Euell. Stockdale, who missed the two Scotland games through injury. A little tentative there, Nemeth. Robinson. He was just looking away to see whether it was on to let it run to Jensen behind him.
Just needed a shout. Don't know whether Jensen did, Martin. A shout of over would have been the one.
Jason Neale just complaining about that.
Well, pretty good. Only 15 minutes for Charlton. Well, that's even better. Three quarters of a mile target.
Working Southgate, the header drops to Robinson. Oh, Bartlett, so close, and wow, Euell couldn't quite round it off. Neale Barry's pointed for the corner.
Well, when you haven't got a goal in 17 games, as Sean Bartlett's record at the moment, Martin. And this should be his first. This is lovely follow-up play from Robinson. Great little ball, just messes the header. That's a goal kick, should have been. But what a chance for Bartlett, who's normally pretty good in the air.
Jensen with the corner, and Schwarzer gets a decision from referee Barry. Charlton in very quickly again, Robinson this time. Coming to collect. Stockdale. Geremi only played it against Powell. Parker. Some space to move into. A lot of space. He's still going.
Lovely run. I think the ball's a little too central in his stance here when he tries to hit it. I think if he'd been able to shift it further to his right-hand side, Martin, he might have got better purchase. He's a little bit straight on. Never really threatening the goal when he just starts spinning it right to left, away from goal. A lovely run, that's what he's capable of. That's what I've missed in many respects this season. Charlton up till now.
He's a youth team player and he's come through the ranks here at Charlton, of course. He was a 15 goals a season man. I'd love to be able to translate that into a Premiership form. Great ball by Queudrue, and Geremi could have made much more of it.
Well, Chris Powell's happy. He gets caught here a little. He's a wing back. He's the only one playing this left hand side, but Jeremy's ahead of him. You can see that, what, 5-10 yards when the ball's played, and it wasn't a difficult ball to control.
Sean Bartlett, being followed now by the player cam. Sky Digital viewers can access that facility via the red button on the remote. Jensen, he loves to link up with the front men.
And Boateng, who loves a tackle.
Jensen again. Felt like a little bit blind, Barker. He thought he knew where Rufus was, but got it wrong. Parker gets back, but he's only presented the ball to Jonathan Greening. He needs to get round the outside. Blocked by Rufus, claims for handball. A couple of incidents like that in the Fulham-Manchester United game yesterday.
Made that Parker's hand, Mark, but I don't think there was any intent. I think it came up off Richard Rufus very quickly.
Rout. Real steady eddy that Charlton are pleased to acquire, but haven't been able to use very much because of a back injury. Mustoe. Stockdale covering more centrally. Here's Massimo Maccarone. It's Kiely's ball.
Well, that's the kind of conditions when the ball's fed into his job like that. It's always going to skip up. You've really got to have a good first touch today. It gets played in with pace to you.
Bartlett with the flick. Anticipated by Euell.
I think it's worth a hit. Again, you can see when people are not on the strongest side here. But look how he gets in behind Robbie Stockdale. And no support, so I think it's worth it, especially when you've just scored.
And where the ball ended up then, there's a segregation, but it's been developed Charlton's way today, with Middlesbrough returning a couple of thousand tickets, and the Valley is cleverly designed and sold on to Charlton fans without problems. So they've got support on all four sides of the ground, around 25,000 Charlton voices being heard with this good start. Full house of just over 26,000. Jensen with the free kick. Down by Rowett. Euell was there. Bartlett couldn't make contact. Middlesbrough looked to break out. Three in red closing down Greening. And the pressure forcing the mistakes. Alan Kirby should be delighted with that.
Yeah, when you don't have the ball, you make a decision, and obviously Alan's made that, Alan Kirby, that they have to press, particularly in the midfield area, not allow Middlesbrough time and space if at all possible. Just take it out you. There's the energy sapping.
Geremi. By George Boateng. The crowd on the far side maybe saw a set of studs raised. Referee didn't. Oh, Rowett's missed it. Nemeth's missed it in terms of the chance. Rowett missed the ball. Nemeth missed the chance to equalise.
Well, in his defence, it must have been very late before he saw it, Mark. I think he's assuming that Gary Rowett's going to deal with this. And when he does it, it's there in a flash and it's instinctive. You stick your foot at this, and if you're lucky, you'll get good contact and test the goalkeeper. It was Nemeth's case, it hit him in the knee and bounced to safety.
He's a player brought in before Steve McLaren's time. And he's had to take his time to prove his worth to the current manager. Fish. Muster. A drill ball wide to Robinson, who has then had to look at it and couldn't be quite sure about his position vis-a-vis offside. The flag went up against him.
Been a bit sloppy, Mark, and Middlesbrough particularly used from the back four. I can look all across there and see one of the players has been real sloppy in their delivery out from the back already in this game. Every one of them has been guilty at different times.
Sound defending by Mark Fish. Charlton's last home win was back in March against Chelsea. Jason Euell got both goals that day. He's given Charlton an early boost here today. Thank you.
This is how see Scott Parker's level of fitness. Martin again played at this pace, his first game back. You know, I don't care how much you're trained, you know, this is the real test of fitness. If it carries on like this, I would be really surprised if he lasts 90 minutes.
I don't think Alan Kirby expects him to last 90 minutes, and maybe not Rowett as well, and that's why they were so worried about Musto's condition. Because he's really had to promise the manager that he can do the full shift in these circumstances. And that fitness query just went off on Friday morning late in training, just feeling a groin problem. Trained properly yesterday, so he should be okay, former Middlesbrough man. Greening. Nemeth came back to it. Bit of fine tuning required.
Yeah, that was a better chance. They haven't quite passed the ball as well as they've done this season. There again, it's another little sloppy ball that they got away with, Nemeth, really, as it came back to him. It really cut hopelessly across it.
Euell, first header was by Bartlett. In the end, John Robinson happy to go down, I think, but he's got his free kick.
Well, does give Charlton a chance for the three centre-backs, Rufus, Fish, Rowett, all to trek forward to the edge of the box and join Bartlett and Euell, and they really have got five players in their map that can all climb, that can all head the ball, and they're all a threat.
Fish.
Again, that's about what, apart from the goal, we've seen Rowett have a header, test the goalkeeper, and then Fish, another one here, just not enough power in the header, but it's a header one again.
There's one for Bartlett back post as well. Powell. Now Nemeth. Just trying to work with Maccarone then. Lads were talking in the studio about how no Italian club came up with the money for Maccarone. I think the answer is quite simply that no Italian club has the money for Maccarone. Did play for Wales as a against Wales as a substitute for Italy in midweek. Second cap, his first was a substitute and an effective one against England, you might recall, at Elland Road back in March. Well, the Charlton players are very angry with Queudrue. It was Neale Barry looked away, followed the ball, and now has an incident to deal with. And he's going to take some advice from his assistant, Gary Britton.
I thought it was a pretty good tackle, I have to say, Martin. The ball was in between them. I haven't seen it again, and I think they both go in here, and again, that's a pretty good tackle. It's both going low, both going for the ball. You watch this in real time. It gets caught, you can see that after the ball's gone, but either one of them could have ended up hurt there. I think the officials have got that one pretty much right. I don't think the players help, do they, when they surround them en masse like that. So I think the referee's done well to keep a bit of composure. Consult his linesman.
Well, he actually did send Frank Queudrue off last season, Neale Barry, but he's not going to do that here, and he's dealing with the reaction of the Charlton players.
You can see the problem he gave himself, though. Boateng, Bartlett, Charlton players see the front man booked in the first minute for a similar type of incident. So that's probably compounded the annoyance there, really, and the disappointment.
Quick word about Monday night. Aston Villa against Southampton, Sky Sports 1. Steve Harrison will have an interest in that, formerly with Aston Villa. Paul Barron, the goalkeeping coach, also formerly worked with Aston Villa. Steve, incidentally, finished his playing career with Charlton Athletic and
started his coaching career at the club that he's visiting today.
I think a lot of the problem as well, Scott Parker talked about how he's been out, first game back. But again, much like Boateng, we're all hoping that he can run that off, and there is no serious or permanent damage done to the foot.
We'll start again with Ehiogu and Southgate. Stockdale. Nemeth. There's a lot of tension around Charlton, of course, particularly after West Ham's win yesterday. They dropped them to the bottom of the table. Alan Kirbishley, who's been in this situation before, of course, and did go down in the 98-99 campaign. Actually, their fate was almost sealed when they lost at Middlesbrough in the April of that season. Robbie Mustoe was a Middlesbrough scorer in that match. Here he is trying to orchestrate better times for Charlton today. Cleared by Boateng, Maccarone hoping that Rowett missed that, but he didn't. Greening. Crossed by Queudrue is a decent one. Fisher's had not a decisive one. Geremi, and Schwab ends up on the deck. Believes that Rufus was responsible for putting him there.
Well, he didn't look too happy, Job. I have to say I'm guilty of a little bit of ball watching myself. It must have
easily
been
done.
It must have been a coming together in the box. You look at the top of the screen there, he just backs away and, well, little touch against each other, but nothing much there.
Wasn't enough really to knock Richard Rufus over though, was there? And he seemed to be quite happy to be on the ground to suggest it was six of one and half a dozen of the other, which it might not have been. Back well for Middlesbrough by Frank Queudrue, who's another summer signing technically. He was on loan last season. Charlton's left-sided man, Chris Powell, moved across to tidy up with the help of Rufus. Bartlett, Jensen. Weaving his way out of trouble.
Well, they've also decided to knock it quite long, Charlton Martin, and I tell you what, the front two have done a really good job for Alan Kirbishley today. Both Euell and Bartlett, because they've really troubled Ehiogu and Southgate aerially. They've won the majority of the balls, and if they haven't, they've only allowed Southgate and Ehiogu to knock it maybe 10 yards back into play. And then from there, they've had Parker and Jensen really do well in catching up the play and winning the second balls.
Greening needing attention off the pitch. Well, they're playing for the team, of course, the two front men, but they're also playing for their places, yeah. Andy. They've had a pretty lean time of it recently.
Listen, the way it's going for Alan just now, if you'd a pair of boots on and you'd have scored in the warm-up, you might have got a game today. Or maybe I'm stretching things a bit there.
Not at all. Fish. To get Greening back on. Job chasing. Middlesbrough fans may be reaching for their remotes because Joseph Desiree's job is now subject to the player cam. Sky Digital viewers. Talked about a lot of former players here today. He's a former Charlton and indeed a former Middlesbrough manager, Lenny Lawrence, with the plenty to say for himself as usual.
Just as well we didn't put all these clubs in that caption, we were struggling.
Yes. Yes, we'd be into stoppage time, wouldn't we? currently the manager of Cardiff, I think.
Yeah, was yesterday.
Yesterday. Stockdale. And Bartlett, of course, booked in the opening seconds of the game and expecting some similar punishment to be dealt out to Robbie Stockdale here.
If I was a Middlesbrough player, if I was out there, Mark, you'd be trying to say to your players, you don't do that. You absolutely know it's a certainty. If you go to ground like that, with the crowd the way they are, and having a couple of dodgy tackles already, you're going to get booked. Simple as that. Stay on your feet, I think, would be the instruction, certainly up till half-time.
Staying in front is Charlton's priority. Hoping to add to their lead. Euell again couldn't wrap his right foot round it. See what was in his mind. It was a real reach in the end.
What was it? Another aerial ball won by a Charlton player. And this is what they've done today. They've won those type of balls, Martin, time and again, and then picked up the second ball like that. Just get away from Euell, just a fraction. It was a little unlucky.
Yes, it's not a criticism particularly of Southgate and Ehiogu, because as you pointed out earlier, there are plenty of players going forward who are good in the air for Charlton. Others were struggling to get the right number of markers who are confident in dealing with the supply that's coming in from set pieces. Queudrue. Mustoe reacted well. It wasn't the best ball to him from Robinson. Boateng. It's Greening. Just run out of room. Presence of Parker also a factor there. 10 minutes to go to half time. It's in the fifth minute that Charlton took the lead. Jensen. Nice take by Bartlett. Euell. Parker. Now Mustoe. Well, confidence is a commodity that Charlton have been lacking recently. Understandable with the results, but it's flowing at the moment, as is some of their football.
And if one or two of the touches had been better around about the box, Martin, they might well have pinched another goal. That one got away from Bartlett as well, the cross in.
And here comes Job. Strength in the ball towards Geremi, and Stocktail very keen to point out to the referee that he did nothing wrong then, having just been booked.
But it's good, isn't it? I mean, the tempo of the game's good. It might not be the silkiest football that we've seen, Martin, but there's a passion, there's an atmosphere, there's a desire all around the football pitch.
And there's a point Graham Stewart made before we kicked off here about the spirit in the Charlton dressing room. They certainly need it in these circumstances, and they are showing it so far.
And we're going to have to keep showing it. This game's a long way from one.
Powell. Mustoe knows enough about Dean Kiely to serve him up on his left foot. Ehiogu, now it saw that coming. Here's Euell. Hardly time for a second touch in the centre of the pitch. Jensen always likes to work with the ball at his feet, but he loses out to Geremi. Geremi gets his cross in. Charlton would expect Rufus to win that at the back post, and he did. Great servant, past 300 games. Now for Charlton, his only club. It's cleverly kept in by Frank Queudrue. Southgate switching the play. Geremi, who scored in the Middlesbrough's last two Premiership games. Remember, they've won the last three in the league. Euell chasing. That's where Southgate and Ehiogu know each other's game so well. Started, of course, for the two of them at Aston Villa. Nemeth. Maccarone. Fine tackle by Fish. Needed to be well timed. Nemeth was gathering pace. And the move was gathering momentum for Middlesbrough. Here's Euell. Here's Powell joining in. Reflects off Stockdale. Should be Mark Schwarzer's.
Yeah, good clean take. Pity it was a chance for Chris Powell to deliver. This game's got a little stretched at the moment, the last 7 or 8 minutes of this half.
Jensen, it's not really the ball-winning type, playing his part, but they've worked a man free here, Middlesbrough. It's Ehiogu. Okay. Here he is again. Geremi, making his pace against Powell, who came up with a pretty positive answer.
First time he's tried that. And when Chris Powell, you're playing as a wing back, you don't have an awful lot of cover alongside you. I think he was just indicating to Mark Fish that he could have done with a little bit of help from the centre back nearest to him. Certainly wasn't forthcoming if Geremi had got round him. But you can't help thinking this is a big 5 minutes for Charlton Martin, the end of this first half.
Yeah, can't place the ball there. He's moved it back in the quadrant now. Queudrue likely to whip it in towards Kiely with his left foot. Over hit. It's a real gung-ho character with a lot of English spirit, if you like, in the French mentality. Kiely, who was born in England, actually a member of that FA school at Lillishall for youngsters, but when the international call came, it came to the Republic of Ireland.
That's another header one there, again, Bartlett up above. Southgate kept it going.
So that was a bit greasy on the pitch.
And it's getting worse, it really has thrown it down at the moment, Martin. It's as heavy as the rain's been today at the moment. Going to slick it up even more, it's going to make room for mistakes. Defenders are going to have to be very, very careful, and front men always on the lookout for mistakes like that on a surface like this.
Offside is forthcoming. Arms are up as soon as Kiely kicked the ball from the Middlesbrough back line. Geremi. Defending from the front. Job. Only had a touch, Massimo Maccarone.
Not quite happening for them, is it, in the last third? I don't think the passing's been up to the usual standard that they've been at the beginning of the season. And that's all over the pitch. I don't think it's been great from back in the midfield and forward. Just haven't quite slipped into gear yet, Middlesbrough.
One of the oldest football cliches, goals change games, and Charlton coming out here very short of goals. Middlesbrough in the mood, on a good run, but it was Jason Euell who took that early chance. And it's a blow that Middlesbrough haven't quite got out of their systems as yet. Drop. Only one away game, that was here in London. It was a very emphatic win at Tottenham. Please, Chris Powell is on the ball here, a boyhood Tottenham fan.
I don't think that was meant for Bartlett, but he didn't have to fire it in.
Yeah, he's got to check back, Powell, as he's trying to play their way around him. Geremi. He's brought to his previous club, Real Madrid, by John Toshak from the football in Turkey. Off Powell. Corner for Middlesbrough. 2 minutes plus added time before half-time at the Valley. Slightly happier Valley at the moment than it has been.
Well, there's going to be about 3 minutes of stoppage time at the end of this half, Martin. Just saw Neale Barry signal to the fourth official. So there's plenty of time, good 5 minutes left in this half.
Ehiogu scored in Middlesbrough's last match against Bolton. Trying to get there this time.
Oh, he wants a penalty, Ehiogu. He's furious. It's always a difficult one, isn't it? So many times you get the decision going your way. I certainly don't think Ehiogu's guilty of anything here, I have to say. Neither did I think Bartlett was, if I'm being honest. I think there was a coming together, but the ball was just behind Ehiogu. Tried to adjust.
It's not a good ground, this, for Hugo Ehiogu. He made his Middlesbrough debut here 2 years ago, only lasted 6 minutes. Tore a hamstring and was out for a while. Not what you want from a big signing. Rowett. Queen might remember that. We'll hear Gordon's thoughts and those of Graham Stewart's with Richard at half time. Queudrue. Nemeth is like a lot of the Slovakian players, as we saw last weekend. Good technique. Maccarone involving Stockdale. They're well represented, Middlesbrough, for the cross. Comes back to Greening. Boateng, now Geremi.
Well, that was the best piece of football on the half by a distance. Worked the ball beautifully from left to right. Got three or four players involved. This isn't a good header or attempted header from Maccarone. He gets nothing on it at all. It was a rather tentative prod with the head. And, well, it could have landed in front of Joe, but it landed behind him. And then this is just high, wide and handsome. But that's the best piece of football.
Now it. Insurance policy, really, in between Fish and Rufus. Kirbishley does switch when his team is not doing particularly well. He hasn't switched in this first half, which tells you a lot about it. It might change in this added time. Greening can't get away. Shepherded out of harm's way by Rufus.
Yeah, he's quite right not to switch anything, Martin. I don't remember Dean Kiely making a save in this first half, which suggests that the boys in front of him, and I'm talking about all eight of them, the three and the five in midfield, have done a pretty good job of protecting the goalkeeper.
Well, he might go as far as saying all ten of them, really, yeah. With Bartlett and Euell battling back. But it's been a high octane, high energy first half for Charlton. Sustaining it will be the challenge in the second half. Geremi. Powell. Jensen.
Down there, not three of them. Brilliant play from Greening, but three red shirts and they haven't given it up.
And Euell it was who won it. This is Robinson. And he's picked out Bartlett. The touch was very much on the heavy side and in the wrong direction. But gone towards goal, he still might have bridged it for a shot. But it was another great example of Charlton going a hunting for possession, even though the ball was in Middlesbrough's half.
I just wonder how long they can keep this going, Charlton. Tempo of the game.
Nat. In for Boxic today, if you missed the earlier news. Swept forward by Rufus, ended on by Parker.
Come on!
Chelsea have won here, Spurs have won here, Arsenal have won here, Manchester United have won here. But at half time, Middlesbrough trail here to Charlton Athletic. Jason Euell in the fifth minute. And they play with great gusto, the home side. Alan Kirbish's team recognising the time of need, bottom of the table at the start of play, but they lead Middlesbrough by 1-0 at the break.
It's live darts coming up next week. The World Grand Prix 2002, Alan Warriner will be defending his title. Phil Taylor's there, Peter Manley and Derris Priestley. Coverage starts Tuesday night from 6 o'clock live on Sky Sports 2. 1-0 to Charlton. Graham Stewart is here, so too Gordon McQueen. We'll get their thoughts on what we've seen when we come back. We'll also be going to White Hart Lane to see how Bolton have been doing against Spurs. Were it not for a nasty cruciate knee injury, then Graham Stewart will be playing this afternoon with Charlton. He's with us. Gordon McQueen is here as well. What do we say? You needed something. You needed fast out of the traps, early goal, and then defend it. So far, it's worked for you, hasn't it?
Yeah, so far so good. Plan A's working nicely, but this is where I wish 45 minutes was the length of a game.
We were wondering whether he'd hit it. You thought not. In the end, it turned out to be a beautiful free kick, didn't it?
Yeah, well, Klaus is excellent on dead ball situations, and he puts a great delivery in there. And Jason gets up with the two Borough lads there, and I think Jason definitely got the last touch there. It'd be a brave man to try and take it away from him anyway. Definitely gets a touch. Whether it touched Boateng on the way in as well is another thing, but it was a great start for us. I think that was only about 4 minutes on the clock.
Just before the game, Richard, we were singing the praises of Middlesbrough defensively, but I can't believe how poorly they've defended set pieces against. I know Klaus Jensen has got great technique in those situations, and they have got an aerial threat, Charlton, but they've been really poor in defending those situations, and that's something Steve McLaren will be working on at half-time.
And they haven't yet forced a save of note from the goalkeeper at the other end, have they?
Well, we were saying about Ehiogu and Southgate, how impressive they've been so far in the season, but I tell you what, the Charlton back three have been exceptional in the first half. They haven't gave Nemeth a sniff, they haven't gave Maccarone a sniff in this first half, and they've done really well. So far, Alan Kirbishley has got his tactics spot on.
Can you keep chasing, harrying, closing in the manner that you are?
I think we're going to be honest with you. They're a fit set of lads out there, and they work ever so hard for each other, and I think we can keep that kind of tempo up, and expect we're a very, very good side defending a lead. The problems we've had is when we've got to break teams down when they're 1-0 up, but all the games that we've gone ahead in, we've looked pretty good in, and I feel that today could just be the start of our season now.
This is what's happening at White Hart Lane. Spurs and Bolton are playing this afternoon. Bolton, of course, in yellow this afternoon. And if it stays the way it is at the moment, they haven't conceded yet, then they will be out of the bottom three tonight. So too will Charlton. Sunderland would be bottom. Manchester City and West Ham. West Ham, who must feel terrific after their win yesterday on their travels, would be back in the drop zone. But Bolton so far appear to be giving as good as they're having to take at White Hart Lane. But, Graham, as you were saying, that's when 90 minutes is a long, long time, isn't it?
Well, absolutely. Obviously, when a game's only 1-0, there's always a danger that somebody can nip up and produce a bit of magic and score you a goal. And, obviously, I hope that doesn't happen here at the Valley today. But, defensively, as Gordon touched on before, we've looked very, very solid. And Gary Rowett coming back into the back three, he's looked very, very composed and cool, and obviously with Richard and Mark Fish marking, they've not given the front two lads too much to go for.
And Bolton are having to do exactly the same kind of job. Clever free kick for Spurs, Redknapp with the hit, but Jeff Astle scoring one like that, I think, for West Brom many years ago.
There's so many clubs figured out this year, actually. You look at the bottom nine, right up to Newcastle in the league, and really, any three of those nine could go down. Is Alan
offside incidentally there, didn't count.
Alan Kirbish has stayed at the start of the programme, a couple of wins, and it doesn't have zoom you up the league, and he'll be praying that he can hold on to this. But Middlesbrough are beginning to creep into it just before half-time, and the warning signs were there. This hasn't been a typical Middlesbrough performance this season. I said earlier that I'd watched them a lot, and they've played really, really well. They've been attractive to watch, but unfortunately that's not been the case in the first 45.
Charlton lead by 1-0. We mentioned the veterans that were here for a reunion earlier. There they all are. They're enjoying their day out so far as well. With us, Gordon McQueen is here as well. Now, they're just a claim that we didn't have the opportunity to see at half-time. Anything in here or not?
No, definitely not. I don't think so. If two players going for the ball, you see it every week. It's very, very harsh if you start giving penalties for thing. You'll have about five or six penalties a game if you start giving them.
Nah, Bartlett maybe just leans in Ehiogu a little bit there, but it wasn't a penalty.
What have Borough got to do? What can Borough do about this?
They've got to start the second half a lot better than they did the first. They had an awful start, misplaced passes at the back, not dealing with set pieces, not dealing with free kicks, corner kicks. Then you got a solid base at the back, and we said that Maccarone and Nemeth had been poorish the first half, or rather, maybe the Charlton back three had been terrific. Then you get better service into those two strikers to give them a chance.
And the dangers for Charlton, Graham, would be what?
But a danger for Charlton is the fact that we lose concentration. I think we've been excellent in the first half. We've played at a great tempo. The back three haven't done anything too risky. They've looked calm and collected, but obviously they need to keep their concentration.
Klaus Jensen will be following for the first 15 minutes of this second half on PlayerCam. That's for Sky Digital viewers on Sky Sports Active. Push the red button on your remote and then follow the instructions. 1-0 Charlton, Andy Gray and Martin Tyler.
Well, it's wet, it's cold, but it'll be a great day for Charlton if they can get the 3 points today. They've won only twice in their last 17 Premiership games. You might remember a Monday night football when they got 3 points that took them to the 40 mark, the magical 40 mark at Tottenham. Chris Powell with a fortunate goal. They didn't win again in 8 games after that, at the back end of last season. And they're two wins this season, they've both come away from home. At Bolton and West Ham. Steve McLaren sent Middlesbrough out early as if to say, we know what we've got to do, go on and turn it around. Certainly should have more to offer in attack than we've seen so far. Gallic shrug from Queudrue. Nice to go back. Euell. Those days, Andy, where you do feel the next goal very, very important.
Well, Grimshaw talked about it. They didn't seem to be having a problem holding on to the lead, but if you look at their home fixtures, the two games that they've taken the lead in, like Chelsea and Manchester United, they've ended up losing both of them.
Greening. Geremi came off Mustoe for the benefit of his old club. Greening. Three in the middle, good reach by Mark Fish.
Not the best ball.
Geremi. Now George Boateng. Maccarone.
From that type of day for the young lad at the moment. You can see what he tried to do, he was just trying to drag it away from Gary Rowett. Just missed it.
But he is one of those players, Andy, who can not catch your eye at all and then suddenly become the decisive player on the pitch.
So it makes some goal scorers, Martin, yeah.
Jensen, good angle for Robinson. Good stop by Schwarzer, in comes Powell! And Ehiogu slid across. Charlton so close to the second goal that they're chasing.
Well, lovely football. Queudrue gets caught ball watching here. And two reasons why they've got the best defence. One, the goalkeeper. And the other, when it came out, a magnificent block from Hugo Ehiogu. Great save and great block.
What's the game?
Just wonder how significant that passage of play might be in the final analysis. Middlesbrough conceded so early in the first half and that had jolted them out of their stride for a long period. Could have happened similarly in the second half. Might yet, of course. Here's Queudrue, who was particularly relieved that didn't lead to another goal for Euell, or indeed for Powell following up. Parker. Control piece of play by Charlton here until Jensen almost spoilt it, but they're still exploring, still probing. Foul. Shifted forward by Boateng, and then job did well. Greening. Maccarone. Nemeth. Job, this is looking better for Middlesbrough. Maccarone coming onto it at pace. And one or two Charlton protested he was looking for a penalty unfairly then. Parker had a say.
He didn't quite collect the ball. That was a problem he had, Maccarone. But that again was a lovely period of play there, a lovely passing movement. He had one like that at the end of the first half, Martin, and that was another slick piece of football from Middlesbrough that they put together there.
George Boateng in need of some attention, so we can look again at this Middlesbrough move.
He doesn't quite collect the return here. You watch this, his jaw plays him in, and it gets away from him a little. Scott Parker just stands his ground here as he plays it. And he goes down to ground rather easily, Maccarone. Referee having none of it, I think quite rightly. Well, we talk about the centre-backs being good, but this boy's played well this season, Martin, in this example. Look at him, near post, shifts his feet across, makes a good block, and then as it goes out, he's up quickly. But look at that for a block from Ehiogu. Good defending all round.
Played over 150 Premiership games now for three different clubs, Coventry, Villa and Middlesbrough. George Boateng. There's a tough cookie in the centre midfield, still in the Dutch national squad. They didn't get on the pitch for their win in Austria on Wednesday. Header for Rufus. So Schwarzer takes the low road this time. It was wasteful from Boateng, but he might still be shaken up. It's interesting in that interview that he did for us. Talked about scoring. He does love to score a goal or two. His record isn't prolific, but it's obviously something uppermost in his mind. Whenever I talk to him, he's on about maybe getting a goal in a televised game. Middlesbrough need a goal from some quarter. Greening. Rather riskily preventing the corner. Couldn't have known where that was going to end up, Gary Rowett. Greening. Another interplay with Queudrue.
It's a great Greening here. He really had Robinson biting away at him time and time again there, but kept his head. Lovely piece of skill to flick through to Frank Queudrue.
Been one little change at the back, Andy, it looks like, for Charlton, that Rufus is playing as the centre man now.
I just wonder if he'd just got himself there though with Rowett coming across. It might have been. We'll see if they change back. Well, if it happens, often centre backs and units just wait until they get a chance to change, but it certainly looks like that's the way they've set up that.
Maybe feeling that there's a full match pace in Rufus's legs if he's run over the top, unlike Rowett, who's missed the last seven Premiership games. Comes out to Geremi. Stockdale. Geremi. And he reacted as though he saw it a little bit late.
I think that's right.
Two up for Charlton. Strong and not fouling Euell, although he was calling for a free kick from the assistant. Powell.
Interesting to see if Middlesbrough get the full-backs in play high up the pitch this second half. When you play against wing-backs, Mark, what your wide players can do, Greening and Geremi, is run the wing-backs away as deep as you want. And it does leave a big gap then if your full-backs want to come in high up the pitch. It means your front men have to work really hard.
We saw Stockdale forward a moment or two ago. Queudrue does play with plenty of attacking spirit.
That was a poor ball from Greening there. Didn't impress his manager either. Straight out on the edge. Not happy with it. Not happy.
Even finally brought to Jonathan Greening from Manchester United. And both moved from the northwest to the northeast. Awkward for Ehiogu. It's always a risk when goalkeeper and defender get so close together, and Schwarzer didn't want to get even closer, so he stood off. Euell was still breathing fire in the back of Hugo Ehiogu, and the outcome is a Charlton corner.
Another header one. Bartlett able to flick it on and keep the pressure.
Quite one that time. Challenge at the far post. Tenth season with Charlton, Richard Rufus. Missed a lot of last season with a knee injury, and it was a case of making do and mending for Alan Kirbishley. Now he's having to do something similar with the added distraction of the transfer embargo. Greening.
That's where they can go. Worked it really well there, Mark. Geremi sucked Chris Powell in, and Stockdale was able to break in behind him.
Job. Greening. Job.
Left heel again, if you want.
Worked it to the other side. So Frank Queudrue met by Rowett. Well able to take a touch and try and pick out a front man. Jason Euell. Bartlett still running and chasing and harrying and forcing a mistake. Euell got back, and Middlesbrough are very grateful for it. He did get caught out early in the second half, but he helped out then.
He made a lot of ground up, didn't he? He was the one who put the cross in, Queudrue. And he's tracked back a good 80, 90 yards. There's no doubt about it. Jason Euell had skipped past Hugo Ehiogu.
Need to use Charlton, or try to use the strength in Mark Fish's arms. For Rowett, so too was Queudrue. He's a bit reluctant to try it again. Robinson. He's one of those players who beavers away at opponents. Hasn't had a great deal of joy today. Decision here is that Euell unfairly turned Ehiogu. You can hear what the majority in the valley think about it.
Linesman gave it, wasn't the referee's decision. Flag went up pretty quickly.
Boateng. Crowd have got to keep their spirits up here, to get nervous on Charlton's behalf, desperate to see their favourites win anywhere, but particularly at the Valley. Again, that's Bartlett. Just needed a touch from Robinson.
There's half a chance of Bartlett. What a run from Chris Powell! Fabulous. Took the attack all the way to them, and when this gets blocked, he's quick enough to just dink this one back in again. This is half a chance for Bartlett, but what a chance for Robinson! Any touch at all would surely have brought the second goal.
Job for Greening. Queudrue. Powell picks it up. Charlton try to pick up the tempo again. Robinson, we talked about the players who've gone a long time without a goal in the Charlton ranks. Far too many of them for Alan Kirbish's liking. John Robinson's in that category. He's not scored in his last 22 appearances before today. He's not going to be allowed to get through. It's another of those illegal turns or easing an opponent out of the way.
Yeah, I think it was probably right there. I'm going to keep an eye on Scott Parker, Martin. He's just really having trouble getting back in. He was the one that made the forward run, but he's at walking pace getting back into midfield.
Robinson, he's full of running. They've got through the first two-thirds of the game well, Charlton. They lead Middlesbrough by a goal to nil. Jensen.
Yeah.
Just shrugged out of it by Boateng. Free kick to Charlton.
We're definitely going to load them in after this. It's a bread and butter decision. You can see Boateng struggling just to ease him out the way. Well, there's a nice little gap there between the defence and the goalkeeper, Martin. Jensen or Parker want to feed it in there. They've got plenty to attack it.
Jensen's looking. And his header. Mark Fish summoned again. To run Middlesbrough out of trouble, but he's run into Mustoe. Nemeth. Greening. Support on the inside, but he goes the far post with the cross. And Rufus had only that option.
They're getting a lot of ball now, Middlesbrough, aren't they? The wide areas, both Queudrue and Stockdale. And Middlesbrough have been able to pick a few passes, put them together and walk the ball wide and get it in good areas. Just haven't connected with a front man yet with a cross in.
Well, there's plenty to try and connect with here from a corner, including Southgate and Ehiogu. Comes towards Ugo Ehiogu. Shifted forward by Jensen. Oh, Robinson. Quite the right thing at the right time, but and got away with it. It's a safer bet to Jensen's feet. He's knocked over by Southgate. Charlton go on. Mustoe waiting for the angle. Fish. Jensen. Wide right is Chris Powell. Swing the right foot at it, and he does. It's a corner, couldn't get it past the first man who was Southgate. And the acoustics at the Valley, tremendous. Brilliant backing for Charlton. Just stuck for Queudrue to hoist it away.
It was a little fortunate that could have come off and been going anywhere.
Just the one goal. Will it be enough for Charlton? Came from Jason Euell. Maccarone charged that down. Well, news from White Hart Lane. Bolton's resistance has been breached. And it's Robbie Keane. Had a look at the assistant first to see that the flag stayed down. It did. That's more good news for Charlton and more bad news for Middlesbrough. Middlesbrough and Tottenham vying for third place in the Premiership at the close of play today. From White Hart Lane for you in a moment. Maccarone, Greening.
Well, there it looks like it's all or nothing now, isn't it?
Triple change. Touch too many, Geremi. How much is all this chasing and harrying taken out of Charlton, particularly the players like Parker, who haven't played for such a long time. Southgate, Greening.
And I just wonder when you see Colin Cooper is one of the changes, Mark. I just wonder if that suggests that maybe it's going to be three at the back for Middlesbrough for the last 25 minutes of this match.
Up. And Euell bounces out off Southgate. Parker. The corner. Parker's got a problem, and it's not just being short of stamina, it's a touch of cramp, maybe.
Yeah, it might well be. I hope it's all that, not a pull. Just swing the right leg at this one. Doesn't quite connect with it. He does get a little deflection, but the shot wasn't a great one.
Schwarzer, he's back on his feet and back in position. Middlesbrough looking to break out here. Nemeth, oh, offside given against Schaub.
That was closer. Disappointing for Middlesbrough. Lovely chance to break here. You see he's nowhere near offside. Charlton get away with that.
Well, here come the Middlesbrough backup brigade. It's an equaliser for Bolton. Yuri Djorkaeff. Marinelli has come on for Maccarone, the young man from Argentina. It's Cooper for Stockdale. Still great to forward, see Colin Cooper resuming his career after personal tragedy.
Replacing number two, Robbie Stockdale, 8 Zerg Nemeth and 9 Massimo Maccarone.
And slightly more blonder Noel Whelan than in the past, Colin Cooper in place of Zillard Nemeth.
Yeah, well, Job's going to play up top with Whelan, it looks like, Martin, and Marinelli wide on the right. It looks like Colin Cooper's going to play right back.
Around and being called over by the referee. No sooner arrived than booked.
Well, Richard Rufus actually runs across Noel Whelan's run. It's much ado about nothing. You see Richard Rufus run into him and just a little clash. I mean, is that a booking? I think not.
Except in the official sense, which it is, because Kenneth Barry has recorded the name of Noel Whelan. Rowett with the free kick. Powell. Jensen, he likes to just work his way in from the left-hand side, but Middlesbrough well aware of that. Powell. Mustoe. Euell. Jensen. Good football from Charlton. Can Parker pick out? Well, some of that hesitation is down to fatigue. I can assure you of that. Jensen gets it in quickly. Spotted by Southgate to deny Bartlett. And miss hit by Geremi. Kishishev, the Bulgarian international, an option for Alan Kirbishley to bring on in midfield. Fish. Strongly in against Geremi.
Safe place for that up there.
There used to be a time we had to wait for the ball to come back. You don't these days, of course. They can use a replacement straight away, but it did bounce down very quickly. Middlesbrough getting on with the job. Greening. Away and then onto the outside of the post and behind for a corner.
Well, he gets a bit fortunate, I think, the goalkeeper here. It's a lovely strike, but having got both hands to it, you do think that he might have pushed it a little bit further away. Seems to get through them. Needed the help from the upright.
Header from close in, Marinelli. I don't know what the Charlton defenders would have made of Kiely not really coming for that one.
It's in there, and close. Jensen does really well against him. You watch them come from the corner of the 6-yard box. Look how close together they are, tugging away at each other's shirt here. Marinelli's unlucky, haven't got the head to it. If it's on target, unless he hits the goalkeeper, he scores.
Maccarone thought he might have done, wished he had. Middlesbrough are still behind, as they have been for the vast majority of this match. Jensen. Mustoe always prepared to back up the play. As judged by Queudrue in particular, maybe Southgate as well. Robinson. Happy to get the throw. Real exercise in concentration and application for Charlton. Prize is such a great one to get off the bottom of the table. They would actually do that with a draw, but they would love to get a win, and they're being helped also by news for White Hart Lane, and it's another for Robbie Keane, and I think it was Gus Poyet who set it up. Good sign for Spurs to have him back. Geremi. Marinelli.
Difficult ball. Difficult ball. And they've worked really hard at the back, Martin Charlton. Back three have defended really well. Disciplined, organised. And I think in front of them, they'll pay real credit to the five that have worked their socks off in front of them to deny them time and space, mirrors to play.
Just sense it could still be a long last 15 minutes or so for Charlton Athletic.
And a lot of late goals in Premiership football these days, we know that only too well.
Geremi saying, is that me?
I think it's George Boateng he wants.
It certainly was George Boateng he wanted.
He just jumps with a knee up.
Former clubs, Aston Villa, play on Monday night against Southampton. Watch it with Richard and Andy, of course, Sky Sports 1. And Petra Bottom Dollar Alan Kirbishley will be watching it. He watches everything.
Didn't look like he was wanting to watch this or the rest of it, did he? Yeah, for a minute.
Yes, this is the hard watch for him, isn't it?
It's been a long time, they've been in the lead for an awfully long time in the match. Well, Boateng doesn't get back to, he's been the one who's picked up Euell for set plays, but just doesn't get back. Level with Jason Euell.
Geremi. Boateng in midfield. Again from Green. Geremi challenged by Jensen, who's certainly punching his weight with the midfield work ethic. Parker digging into his well of energy. We shouldn't forget he's very young. He might not have played much, but he's certainly got youth on his side.
Yeah, he has. And that was good energy and good speed.
Still only 22.
Every one of those, they'll just saps him a little bit more in the first game.
Nothing sapped you when you were 22. At least not when you were on the pitch.
I wondered where you were going.
And where's Marinelli going? With Whelan. Oh, there was a bit of a deflection on that. Off Parker, who was challenging Marinelli as he shot. The curve didn't discomfort Dean Kiely in the end.
No, it wasn't so pronounced, Martin, that caused him a problem.
Well, he struck early. Can he do it again late? Maybe you can find out by following the player cam if you're a Sky Digital viewer via that red button on the remote.
Well, they're asking Scott Parker from the sidelines, are you ready? Do you want to come off?
Dean Kishishev, who played in both Bulgaria's wins against Croatia and Andorra over the last few days. Referee check with his assistant. But, a corner for Charlton.
No, it's a free kick, Mark. I think he's given a free kick, the linesman. I don't think it's a corner at all.
He obviously saw something in the tugging of the shirt, something like that, yeah. Well, change is going to be made. And it's a 1-0 thought.
This is Chef Parker. A big welcome back to one of Charlton's own. He goes off, having featured prominently in the way Charlton have held this lead.
Robbie Mustoe looks like he's trotting over as well, Martin.
And there was the doubt about Mustoe. This is Luke Young. He lost his place today. He's asked to see it through in the last 12 minutes or so. Jensen takes this free kick. So some fresh legs for Charlton.
Just make sure the bed end get organised quickly, that's the thing. Looks like Luke Young's going to play right side of the three central defenders. Robinson's moved to the left of the three central players, Kishishev in there as well, alongside Klaus Jensen. Those are the three narrow players now.
It's still the three centre-backs.
Yeah.
Marinelli looking to link up with Geremi. Marinelli has stayed down. No eyes in the back of his head, that's all that Luke Young could do. Marinelli is up and Middlesbrough wasting no time restarting the game. So there's a foul by Kishishev.
You've just got to be careful, Charlton. They don't encourage too much pressure by giving away daft free kicks in areas like this.
Geremi. Any sort of touch, yeah, by friend or foe.
Or none at all, as we've seen.
Yeah, yes. Yes.
Can be a real danger.
Especially when it sets in a slightly wider position. As Middlesbrough's greatest ever goal scorer once said, Brian Clough, only takes a second to score a goal. Yeah, Cloughy on the radio yesterday sounded in wonderful spirits. I'm sure he's enjoyed Derby against Nottingham Forest today. Got a hat-trick here in the Valley in a 6-6 draw between Charlton and Middlesbrough. Those were the days. Middlesbrough would take a 1-1 draw here. Greeny probing to that effect. Queudrue. Greening again. Put in an effective one from John Robinson. Kishishev. Well, it's 10 minutes of a little flyby for Steve McLaren, but for Charlton, in their circumstances, every minute will seem like an hour. It's only a throw. Marinelli. And Joel Boateng's back. Powell. To their credit, Charlton haven't sat back. They've tried to push forward to get some support to Bartlett and Euell. There's a temptation to be cautious and try and run down the clock. Untidy contact there by Bartlett.
Well, I just think it's important that they keep discipline at the back in particular. If Young and Powell, the two wide players, don't get forward, I don't think that Alan Kirby should be too bothered in the last 6 or 7 minutes of this match, Martin, but it's so important that they defend with discipline.
Queudrue. Free kick to Charlton, cutely earned.
Yeah, they'll take all of those and they'll take the time with them. I honestly don't think that Middlesbrough have done enough, and I might be saying that a little early with over 7 minutes plus stoppage time, but they haven't done enough. Steve McLaren's side today, having gone a goal behind, I thought we'd see more from them. I don't think we have seen them at their best, but you have to credit Charlton with, when they haven't had the ball, being very difficult to play against.
Yeah, you. Stayed in there, the defenders came out. Need to stop the game, even though the flag went up, Neale Barrett. Whelan can't hold it up. Powell. It was again Robinson feeling the contact, knowing he could go down, get the free kick. Cooper frustrated. A few more seconds pass by. Time on Charlton's side. All those old players here, we're hoping that they've come on a great day for the club, an important day, maybe a pivotal day in a change in the structure of the season to this point.
I have to say I've been impressed with the fans, the Charlton fans, Martin. They've played their part today.
Geremi. Fish wondering whether the goalkeeper is going to get involved. Young, rather desperate forwards, appeals for handball by Geremi, not given. Queudrue. Whipped away by Jensen. That's not what Middlesbrough need from Frank Queudrue. Rowett. And the Euell up front at the moment.
They just might get a bit nervy now. With that twitchy time, Charlton. And victory is very, very close. We'll still have to see it out.
Mervyn Day alongside Alan Kirbishley. Geremi. Breaks here for Queudrue. Geremi. All but Ewell back for Charlton. Job. Whelan. No one in a white shirt behind him.
Getting a free kick against Job. Felt he was leaning in against Rufus. I don't know what Job wanted to do, he wanted to let it go. He just eases Richard Rufus, at least that's what the referee decides here as he leans into him.
See the contact when defenders do it, yeah. They don't get penalised.
No,
do 4 minutes plus added time. To take this free kick, Charlton. And the two smiles, but nervous ones.
Well, for the first time, neither of the centre backs goes up, Martin. That's sensible.
Jensen. Who's going to be first of this? It's Hugo Ehiogu. Kishishev was trying then. I don't think it was a shot. It flew away well wide of the goal. Very popular in the Charlton dressing room. Noticing Kishishev, one of the chaps, as they say. Fish. Four Premiership home defeats, and throw into that the ignominy of being knocked out of the Worthington Cup on this ground by Oxford United.
Yeah, I think there's about 2 minutes stoppage time plus what's left. Around about 5 minutes for Charlton to see out.
Job not complete. completed yet, but they're happy to get the whistle here. It's been that sort of day for Middlesbrough.
You know, I think the thing that Alan Kirby will be, I know he won't be comfortable and confident even now, but it's not as if his team are pinned back in there, Mark, and they're under terrible pressure and their backs against the wall. They're fairly comfortable, dare I say, at the moment. And again, I have to reflect on how many times Dean Kiely's worked. Steve McLaren will be really disappointed they haven't worked the goalkeeper more than they have. That save from Greening about the best effort that they've had. But we know in this game that there is still time for anything to happen.
Ehiogu to Southgate. Geremi. Job calling for the ball to feed. It goes wide to Cooper. Away from Rufus. He's got another free kick. John Robinson. No wonder he's having a little grin. A minute plus added time. Marinelli can't dwell on it. Robinson tracks back. Schwarzer has to kick long. He's the happiest of goalkeepers with the back pass. Boateng. Greening. Middlesbrough need a moment of inspiration here. Queudrue, Greening. Kishishev just hold him off and track the run as well. Geremi facing the play. Marinelli, Geremi. Great blocking by Charlton again. It's been typical of their industry today.
Yeah, Rowett and Kishishev both there, attempting to block the shot.
2 added minutes, we're into that. Queudrue. Geremi. Kiely taking his 6 seconds and maybe a little bit more.
Just a touch. A good sensible throw. And possession, if you can.
Euell. Powell. Middlesbrough have it back. But they've got to have it forward. And it's Charlton's throw. More credit to Alan Kirbishley, who obviously had to work out a battle plan for this. To decide which players to keep in the team. He left a couple out. And his philosophy has been spot on, it seems, at a time of real need for Charlton.
Yeah, the other goal helped. I don't think there's a doubt about that, Martin. But they've worked the socks off, they've stuck to the plan, particularly when they don't have the ball. I think that's the most important thing, and they've done it. They've worked their manager's orders out really well.
And if they can, they'll keep it in this corner. The right man on the ball from their point of view, Jensen, but strong-armed out of it. Fish.
Yeah, that'll do them. It's a long way to go in 13 seconds.
Crowd urging Neale Barry to blow the final whistle. Tremendous support for Charlton today. They've not been dragged down as the team's dropped down. Kishishev trying to delay the taking of the free kick. Here comes Southgate. This is the last roll of the dice for Middlesbrough. Queudrue. Oh, 2 minutes up and more. Charlton are off the bottom.
thanks to their first home win since March, their first home points this season. Jason Euell in the fifth minute, who'd have thought when he scored it, it would win the game. But Charlton were strong enough and organised enough, and Middlesbrough, it has to be said, were off the pace enough for that to happen. Middlesbrough had made an impression this season, a good one, but it is their third away defeat in their last four games on their travels. A much more cheerful Charlton Athletic. Charlton 1, Middlesbrough 0.
Tomorrow night, Monday Night Football, comes from Villa Park. 7 o'clock start as usual on Sky Sports 1. It's Aston Villa against Southampton. And for Graham Stewart, Alan Kirbishley and his team, bottom end of the Barclaycard Premiership looks like this. Bolton, who are beaten today by Spurs, but we haven't shown you all the goals. They're to come. They go bottom. Sunderland down one. Manchester City into the drop zone. West Ham and West Brom both falling as well. Charlton up into 15th. Talk to Graham and Gordon when we come back. 1-0 Charlton here. And this is the goal that did it. From Jason Euell. All the reaction to that, man of the match, and the goals from White Hart Lane when we come back. World's a very different place when you're not bottom. That's how different. Okay, let's find out who was the Barclaycard man of the match. Here's Claire Tomlinson.
Gary, a change of system for Charlton today. What was the game plan?
I think really it was to emphasise our play rather than worrying about them, which you know we do sometimes, and you tend to do when you're in a little bit of a slump, which we're in. So I think we tried to be positive and perhaps go. We knew they played three up front, so we tried to go three on three, which you know is a dangerous game at times. But we felt we needed to do something a little bit different, and you know as you can see, it worked.
Could you have asked for a better start to the game?
No, not at all. No, that's what we need. That's what we've needed. We've said all along, you know, we need a little bit of luck. I know everyone says that and it's a little bit of a cliche, but, you know, we've been playing not too badly this season, but we've been losing by a goal and, you know, it's very demoralising when it keeps happening. So to go a goal up, you know, just gave us that little bit of emphasis to work even harder. I mean, to be honest, you know, the work rate by the lads was absolutely fantastic.
With that in mind, you've been out for the last eight games. How tired are you now?
Yeah, I'm not actually too bad because I played in the middle. I didn't have to do it. Everyone else did my running for me. So, no, it was good. No, I've worked hard and you know, I was just really determined just to try and enjoy it. I mean, if you can do that in our position. But, you know, the fact that I've been out for so long with really silly little things and last season. So, you know, I just tried to enjoy it and what a way to enjoy it and win.
With just the one goal, though, and 85 minutes left to survive, confidence can't have been high. What was that like?
No, it was difficult, but, you know, we were always on the front foot. We never really let them get too much of a, you know, a pattern of play going. We tried to snuff everything out. You know, we were tight in midfield. We tried to be tight at the back. And the forwards did fantastically well as well. You know, they took a lot of pressure off us by holding it up. And although we didn't score another goal, you know, we looked as though we could have done, which is something that perhaps we haven't done lately. So, you know, it was a good performance all round.
Off the bottom, up to 15th, and the Barclaycard man of the match.
Thanks very much.
Well done.
Thank you.
Well done.
Cheers.
How does that feel, then?
Oh, it feels great, mate. It feels absolutely fantastic. But I think, you know, the clip you saw there of Chrissy Powell running out, that pretty much sums up the relief through everybody feels in this stadium at the moment, because psychologically you don't want to be propping the league up, and to move up about five places there is a good confidence boost.
You've got to work
lads.
With a smile on your face tomorrow morning.
Absolutely. I mean, in fairness to the lads, they've been smiling. We've tried to keep spirits high and what have you, but as Gary said there, it does get a little bit demoralising when you keep losing games. You know, you perhaps don't deserve to, and today they worked their socks off and got their just rewards.
Middlesbrough had a long time to put it right, Gordon, but couldn't find a way through. Was that as a result of things that they were doing, or
with a
what Charlton did?
Bad start to the game, losing a goal early. That's the last thing you wanted here today, to give Charlton a bit of confidence when confidence is low here, but obviously playing at home. You know, and in these situations, I mean, he's got great delivery, Klaus Jensen, and it's a terrific header by Euell, but at the same time, right throughout the first half, they defended free kicks and corner kicks very poorly indeed, and that's normally one of Middlesbrough's strengths, but that's something they've never done in the first half today. And it's obviously a huge win for Charlton, desperately needed it, but at the same time it's a big, big blow for Middlesbrough. I mean, a chance to go third in the league today, a chance to show in front of a live TV audience just how well they have been playing this year, and They never turned it on today. And of course, with a lot of big games coming up, you know, Leeds, Newcastle, Liverpool, Chelsea, you know, a chance to climb up that league. But I've got to say, just what Gary Rowett's saying, the front two were terrific for Charlton today. The back three defended really well. Mustoe, Parker, Jensen worked really hard in the middle of the park, and they deserved a victory.
Doesn't matter now, but you could have done with a second to breathe a little more easily in that second half, couldn't you?
Yeah, we could have done. I mean, the lads worked ever so hard first half, and Andy was saying in commentary, could we keep that tempo up for the whole game? And we couldn't quite keep it going, and we dropped back a little bit, and you know, there were times when we broke away and we could have just done with that second goal on the break.
This was the best chance, I think, of the afternoon, wasn't it?
It was. John Robinson's done brilliantly there, picked out Jason, and he's done everything right. He's hit the target, and hats off to Mark Schwarzer, who's made a great save there, and a terrific block by Ehiogu as well.
They didn't work the keeper enough. We said that half-time, Gordon. I think the same to some degree was true of the second half as well, but eventually when Dean Kiely was called upon, he came out with a very, very good save.
Yeah, they came a bit closer in the second half, tried to step it up a little bit midway through the second half. And it's a terrific strike by Jonathan Green. I just thought it was going to slip in between Kiely's hands here. I mean, we're right behind us in that studio, but he just done enough to get it onto the post. But it was a great effort and a very good save as well.
So, Charlton, you say, imposed themselves in the game more rather than Middlesbrough.
Well, I honestly thought it was a disappointing performance from Middlesbrough. I mean, I've watched a lot of them this year, and I've been really impressed the way they're going about their business. And I mean, the last away game at Tottenham, they won 3-0, played great, could have won 6. Today, they never done themselves justice. They never really played well at all. But maybe that's taken away a bit from Charlton, because they really did work their socks off for their manager today. The crowd got right behind them, which was terrific to see for Alan Kirbishley. Alan Kirbishley couldn't ask for any more from his players than he got today. And as I say, they deserved their win. I don't think there's any question about that.
Rowett was man of the match. Was Parker far behind him in that vote?
No, not far at all. I mean, for a lad as young as Scotty is, and to have been out with a pretty serious injury for 8 weeks, to come back and play with the power and determination that he did in the middle of the park gave everybody around him a boost. And I think, you know, he set the tone really for us. It would purely just with his enthusiasm and work rate. And, you know, when you look at his name on the team sheet as a player, you feel good because you know what you're going to get from Scott Parker, and we've certainly missed him.
And it's a clean sheet, your first in 11. How important is that?
Another very, very important statistic for us. And yet again, we saw with the save there with Dean Kiely, you know, just when you need your keeper, he pops up and produces a great save like that. And, you know, a few more clean sheets and nicking a few more goals will be right up that league.
Let's find out what Steve McLaren made of it all. He's with Claire Tomlinson.
Steve, a face like thunder when you came off the pitch. What wasn't working today?
I think every game you set out in the first 20 minutes to make it difficult, and we didn't. The first 20 minutes they dictated. They had a great attitude, a will to win, and it set the tempo for the rest of the game. We competed after the first 20 minutes. We showed a good attitude. We kept going for the 90 minutes, had chances in the second half, tried to change things. But it was just one of them days where it wasn't really going to go right, and we had too many sort of below par performances.
A triple substitution for you in the second half. Did you hope that would kickstart things?
Well, you always try something, and you always think that, you know, we give it 20 minutes to see if things would work out, and then we always had changes in mind, and we just thought that might upset their rhythm. But credit to Charlton. You know, we've got no excuses. You know, they showed a great attitude today. Got amongst us, got about us. And, you know, we mixed it and we competed. We showed a good attitude, but we're better than that. Our quality on the ball, our quality on the break wasn't as it has been.
The away form is assuming a desperate pattern, though, really, isn't it? It's just the one game now that you've got the points from.
Yeah, that's right, but we've had tough away games and nobody comes here and finds it easy. And we could have got a draw today, but no, as long as the players show the attitude that they did, a little bit more quality, we'll be okay.
Have harsh words been spoken?
No, not really, no. Maybe at half-time, as you say, you try things to kick-start them, but definitely not. They've done well, the players. They're only a young bunch. They'll learn from this, and maybe we didn't come back from the break as well as what we should have done. But no, we've got a week now, and we've got Leeds next week. So no, there's no harsh words. Applauded their attitudes, as long as they show that. There'll be no criticism from me or the staff.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
When we come back, we're off to White Hart Lane to see how Spurs got on today against Bolton Wanderers. Third place, of course, up for grabs. If they could win and Borough lost here, it would be theirs. That's next. So Charlton are off the bottom, winning at the Valley today by a goal to nil. We've heard from Steve McLaren, who said it was just one of those days for Middlesbrough. What then of Charlton? Here's Alan Kirbishley with Jeff Shreves.
Well, Alan, has that put a smile back on your face?
It's a little bit of relief. You know, I think that to score, what we said before the game, you know, to score early is a bit of a change for us. And certainly, I think no one could work as hard as they worked after that. And I think it was a good performance. I think that the only thing I can complain about is that, you know, they worked ever so hard to win the ball back and didn't really work that hard to keep it. You know, they gave it straight back to Barrow a lot. But I'm well pleased with the result.
Surely today isn't a day to complain about anything, though.
No, because we had to win at some stage. We knew that, and I just wish it had been a little bit earlier. But, you know, I think we restricted Barrow to one shot in the second half and a couple of goal-mouth scrambles, and we had the best chances, and it could have quite easily been two or three.
Claire just spoke to Steve McLaren. He said you won purely because of your work ethic and your will to win.
Well, I think when you've lost four on the spin at home, you know, if you ain't getting that work ethic, then you're going to be in trouble. And, you know, it's one thing that we've always got. But, you know, we've played better than that and not won. But I was well pleased with the performance, and I think the players that came in, you know, Parker lasted for the 70-odd minutes and Rowett, obviously, the whole game. And, you know, it's good that the squad is as strong as we can get it without Graham Shute at the moment. And, you know, they're going to have to have that competition in there and pick some more wins up, because it's not nice being down the bottom.
You say you weren't panicking, but it must be a relief to shoot up to 15th in the table.
Yeah, I mean, I spoke to the players before the game and we was talking about can we kickstart our season, because we haven't really got going yet. We should have won a game here, at least out of four. And as I say, the last away game at Fulham, we should have got something. But it is a tight division, and you know, if you can put two wins on the board on the spin, then you can suddenly move into mid-table.
I was going to say, how important do you now build on the back of this?
Well, it's nice to keep a clean sheet. That's one thing, and obviously nice that we've scored a goal. You know, we've been given a lot of stick this week, but there's quite a few clubs underneath us with less goals scored than what we have. But obviously, if you're down the bottom, then you know, you ain't scoring enough goals.
I mean, you're keeping a lid on it, but you must be really big. Clean sheet, you've scored a goal, first win at 11 at home.
But you know what happens, that, you know, we've had all the press down this week, and, you know, oh, what's it like, you're bottom of the league or you're second from bottom? You know, I'd be no different if we were second from top. Perhaps at the end of the season, when you take me out for a drink, I might be, but I'd be no different if we were second from top now, second from bottom, because, you know, there's so many highs and lows in the season, and you've got to keep it nice and even.
Well done today. I wish you good luck for the rest of the season. Good luck in getting a drink out of me.
Thank you.
I think you'd feel different if they were second from top. Spurs, of course, had the incentive of going third from top today if Middlesbrough lost here and they beat Bolton. It's to White Hart Lane we go. Bolton in the yellow here. Commentator Martin Fisher.
Gardner on for Ricketts. Ricketts for Bolton! Well, it's an audacious little chip by Gardner. Redknapp with a shot! How close. And Masrovic is. This is Sheringham. It's behind Davis, but there's loads of room in which to operate. Davis, car ahead of him. Davis for Redknapp. Miscues it, Sheringham, the flag's up. It won't count. The flag is up. In ahead of Gardner, little flick on for Keane. It's fallen for Carr. Hasn't lost any of the power in that right boot, Stephen Carr. What a return that would have been for the Irishman. Sheringham's touch, Keane on for Sheringham. It's delicious. Will it be a goal? Well, Jaskalainen with his first real save of the afternoon. Perry, that's a bit loose. Jorkaeff looking for Ricketts, flag stays down, wonderful chance, and he's missed it. Kunjevcevic, of all people, up from the back, looking for Davis. Keane! Robbie Keane opens his White Hart Lane account. It's been on the cards. And he sent the home fans into delirium. Nolan again. Djorkaeff trying to find room and has done. He's onside this for the equaliser, and it's there! Yuri Djorkaeff for Bolton Wanderers. Terrifically executed goal. And it's won by Whitlow. Freund again. Davis again. This is Gus Poyet. Is this the chance? This is Keane, and it's there! Robbie Keane at the double! Poyet's low cross, and Keane in there, ahead of Nolan. And it's three against two in Tottenham's favour. Keane and Sheringham ahead of him. It's got to go left to Sheringham. Here is Teddy Sheringham. It's open in front of him. He's picked out Davis. This to settle it. This for 3-1! Game, set and match. Tottenham Hotspur. It's three to Tottenham, and it's three more points for Tottenham. And back up the table they go.
And Robbie Keane was waiting for the hat-trick, wasn't he, on the far post. Back up to third, they do go. From the top, Liverpool, beaten now just once in 27, remember. A point clear of the champions, who lost for the first time in 31 yesterday. Then Spurs, then Manchester United down into fourth place. Middlesbrough falling as well, and Chelsea, as a result, of course, of Tottenham's movement. Behind them come Fulham, Blackburn Rovers, Everton up into ninth this weekend, and Leeds United. From the bottom, it's Bolton Wanderers now, rock bottom, where Charlton started the day, Sunderland and Manchester City, the three in the drop zone, just outside West Ham, who started the weekend bottom, of course. Then it's West Brom, Charlton up into 15th with 10 from their 10 played. Ahead of them, Aston Villa and Southampton, who meet tomorrow night on the Monday Night Football. We start at 7 o'clock as usual on Sky Sports 1. Then come Birmingham City, who led until late in the game at the Hawthorns, finished with one apiece. And Newcastle United, who of course got thumped by Blackburn Rovers this weekend. All the goals and the talking points tomorrow night. The last word on the weekend's football with Andy tomorrow. 7 o'clock start, Sky Sports 1. Now, Middlesbrough, you started the day, Gordon, saying could mix it. You believed could finish top six. They'll have to do better than that in order to do so, won't they?
Well, I think Steve McLaren summed it up in his interview at the end of the game. He said they had a bad day at the office and they can do a lot better. And they have been doing a lot better this year. I was very disappointed in them today after having watched them so many times this season, playing some really, really good football. As we'd mentioned earlier, lovely and solid at the back, seemed to have the blend right in the middle of the pack and looking dangerous up front. Well, there was very little of that in evidence today. I think certainly the central defenders, I don't think Hugo Ehiogu and Gareth Southgate have had a more uncomfortable afternoon this season. I mean, because Bartlett and Euell really did work hard and put themselves about today and made life very, very difficult for them. I think you could maybe ask me in three, 4 weeks' time just where Middlesbrough are going to be. I think in the next four games, I think I've got Leeds at home, Newcastle away, Liverpool at home, Chelsea away. You know, all the teams, forget Liverpool, they're going to finish in the top three with Manchester United and Arsenal. I don't think there's any question about that. But the ones that Middlesbrough could be competing with, like Chelsea, Newcastle, Leeds, they play them in the next few weeks and that'll be a big, big test for them then, and we'll see how we come out of those results in a few weeks' time. And if they're still up there, third, fourth position, you know, I think, as I said, if they get the rub of the green, that they have a little bit of luck with injuries, I think they can stay up there.
I said I thought Alan Kirbyster would feel different if he was second from top. You corrected me and said, oh no, is what you see what you get? He doesn't change a great deal?
No, pretty much so. He doesn't change. I mean, he's a very down-to-earth fella, really. And he doesn't get too excited if we're winning, and he don't get too low if we're losing. And it's not a bad way to be honest with you, with the pressures that are around in this Premiership at the moment. So, but underneath, he will be delighted. He'll be proud of all the lads who went out there from 1 to 11. They gave him every little drop of sweat they had. And, you know, we'll need to show that desire every single time we go out there this season if we're going to make sure we stay out of trouble.
Do you play football at a club like this fearing inevitably a battle every year, or have Charlton moved on beyond that?
I think we feel we've moved on beyond it, but you know, it showed with Ipswich last year that they could, you know, it can, you can finish fifth one season, all of a sudden you're relegated the next. So, you know, you don't rest on your laurels ever in this division, because all of a sudden you find yourself with, you know, a bottom three position. But we feel that we've got the squad that is capable of finishing at least mid-table, and that for Charlton is success.
And Liverpool lead, Gordon, you say those three, the three we expect, will finish.
Yeah.
But in what particular position? Who do you think?
We mentioned earlier, absolutely everybody raving about Arsenal going to win absolutely everything. And some of their football this season has been breathtaking. But the bottom line is, Liverpool are above them now in the league. It was far too early in the season to be shouting for the rooftops that Arsenal were definitely going to win the league, which a lot of people were. I mean, they've got a great chance. I still think they're favourites, and I still think they'll win the league. But I think it'll be really, really tight this year. I think I think Liverpool have improved, and Manchester United, if they can hang on in there while Nistelrooy or Keane or Ferdinand's out, and it's going to make it a really interesting second half of the season. But right now I'd go for an Arsenal, Liverpool, Manchester United for second and third, but it's early days and anything could happen. A couple of bad weeks in this league, you can be out a cup, you can lose two games in the league, lose a couple of key players, and lose a big game in Europe or something, all of a sudden your season falls flat in its face.
Start of the day, bottom. We said it was a gloomy valley then. The place looks a lot happier now. We'll see you tomorrow night for the Monday Night Football.